Hello everyone. Am I live? Am I visible? Am I audible? Give me a thumbs up in the chat box, someone, if I'm clearly visible, audible. Let me confirm if it's working. I will start the session at. Give me a minute to confirm. Yes, I hope it's working. So I welcome you all for today's session. A very, very good afternoon to all of you. Am I audible? Am I audible? Yes, it's working. Yes. So let me start the next session. So in this session, I'm going to teach you a very important from cardiovascular system, that is endocarditis. The most important topic in cardiovascular system. So that is endocarditis. We are going to start now. So what is endocarditis? Without wasting any further time, let me come directly on the topic. What is endocarditis? In pathology, anything, itis is the inflammation. Itis. It is appendicitis, bronchitis, meningitis. So it is itis means inflammation of that particular organ. So it is endocarditis means inflammation of the endocardium of the heart. So before coming on the inflammation of the endocardium of the heart, it's important to understand the layers of the heart. You can see a heart in this diagram. You can see the four chambers of the heart. So in the heart, there are three layers. You can see in this diagram, the red color layer, the innermost layer, the red color layer is the endocardium. Can you see? Innermost is the endocardium. The middle layer, the black color, is the myocardium, which is the thickest layer. And outermost is the pericardium, the outermost layer. It is like a thin membrane, pericardium. So endocardium, myocardium, pericardium are the three layers of the heart you can appreciate in this diagram. There can be endocarditis, inflammation of the endocardium that I am teaching right now. Myocarditis is the inflammation of myocardium that I will teach you in some other session, not in this one. And pericarditis is the inflammation of the pericardium, right? So inflammation can occur in any layer of the heart. Endocarditis, myocarditis, pericarditis are respectively the three diseases which occur due to the inflammation of endo, myo and pericardium respectively. Whenever in some diseases, all three layers of the heart can be inflamed together. So that disease is known as pancarditis. Such a disease is known as pancarditis. So pancarditis means inflammation of all three layers. So these are the basics I guess you must know, right? Now in this diagram, you can see the three type of layers. Now coming on this diagram again, can you see the walls inside the heart? Inside the heart, we have walls. So we have bicuspid wall, tricuspid wall, we have semilunar walls, pulmonary wall, aortic wall, various walls are present. Can you tell me the layers of the heart? What is the composition of the wall? Wall contains which layer? Does it contain endocardium, myocardium, pericardium or all of them? Heart walls contain only endocardium. The walls of the heart contain only endocardium. No myo, no peri. They are composed of endocardium. Right? You must know that. Now, can I say endocardium is of two type? Can I say endocardium is of two type? The endocardium which is present over walls is known as valvular endocardium. Because it is because it is composing the walls, right? And rest of the endocardium in the three-dimensional heart, the rest of the endocardium, apart from walls, the rest of the endocardium is known as mural endocardium. Can I say? So endocardium is of two types. Now in this diagram, can you appreciate the three layers? Can you appreciate the two types of endocardium? Appreciate valvular endocardium and mural endocardium first. Appreciate the two types of endocardium. This is valvular endocardium and this is mural endocardium. Have you appreciated? Appreciate the middle layer myocardium and appreciate the outermost layer pericardium. Is it? Can I move ahead? So these are the three layers of the heart. Now I am teaching you endocarditis. Let's start the endocardial inflammation. Myocarditis, pericarditis, in some other session I will teach you. So endocarditis is the inflammation of the endocardium, right? So tell me that. So what is the definition of endocarditis? Endocarditis is the inflammation of the inner layer of the heart, that is endocardium. Since the walls of the heart walls, are also made up of endocardium. So all endocarditis involve the heart walls. It is a rule. In all type of endocarditis, the heart walls will be involved. Right. So we have seen the layers. Now coming on the classification, we can classify endocarditis into two categories. The first is the rheumatic endocarditis, which is the most important. And others, non-rheumatic endocarditis, there are three endocarditis. Right. So it is Lipmann sac endocarditis, that is endocarditis occurring in SLE, that is known as atypical or Lipmann sac endocarditis. Non-bacterial thrombotic endocarditis known as NBTE. And third one is bacterial or infective endocarditis. So basically in this session, it is a marathon session, a long session, maybe a 2 hour or maybe more than that. So in this, I am going to cover all four type of endocarditis one by one. I will be starting with the rheumatic endocarditis, which is the most important one. And after that, I will be coming on the non-rheumatic endocarditis, which are three in number. So Libman's egg endocarditis, that is endocarditis occurring in SLE, non-bacterial thrombotic endocarditis, which occurs in hypercoagulable states of the heart, and bacterial endocarditis, also known as infective endocarditis, which occurs in sepsis or infection of the heart, right? So these are the three non-rheumatic ones. So I am in the end, we will complete this table. Have a look on this table. We will read this complete table in a comparative manner in the end. Let me start the endocarditis one by one. So currently, I am starting the first endocarditis, rheumatic endocarditis. One more thing I would like to add here is that I am going to teach you these four endocarditis. So in Libman's sac, only endocardium is involved, so endocarditis. In non-bacterial thrombotic endocarditis, that is NBT, also endocardium is involved, that is endocarditis. In bacterial also endocardium is involved, endocarditis. But in rheumatic, all three layers are involved. So in rheumatic, not only endocarditis, rheumatic endocarditis, rheumatic myocarditis, rheumatic pericarditis. All three layers are involved, so basically there is pancarditis. So I can say that rheumatic may endocarditis ke saath, other two layers are also involved. So there is basically pancarditis. Let me start the first one. Are you people with me? Can I start the first endocarditis? Rheumatic heart disease. But before teaching you rheumatic endocarditis, or I will not say only endocarditis, as I have told you, ki rheumatic may not only endocarditis, myo and peri also happen. So I will say rheumatic heart disease, in which all three layers are involved. I will teach you endocarditis also, myo also, peri also in rheumatic heart disease. But before teaching you rheumatic heart disease, I would like to teach you rheumatic fever. Now, is there a difference between rheumatic fever and rheumatic heart disease? Yes. Rheumatic fever is an umbrella term. It includes five diseases. One of them is rheumatic heart disease. So what is rheumatic fever? What is rheumatic fever? Now, for understanding rheumatic fever, I would like to tell you a story. Can you see this diagram? See this diagram. In this diagram, can you see this is a child? Rheumatic fever occurs mostly in child, right? So can you all see this is a child? This child is having tonsillitis or pharyngitis. Can you see? These are the tonsils of the child. The tonsillitis, pharyngitis are very common in child, right? You and me, all we have tonsillitis and pharyngitis in our childhood. So it is a common disease. So this child is having tonsillitis or pharyngitis by a bacteria. The name of the bacteria is group A beta streptococcus. Yes, group A streptococcus. Group A beta streptococcus bacteria. Yes, bacteria is causing pharyngitis. So group A beta streptococcus bacteria is causing tonsillitis or pharyngitis in this child. Imagine that, right? So what will happen? The body will form antibodies against the bacteria. You will say, ma'am, yes, of course, humoral immunity will be activated and the antibodies will be formed against this bacteria. So these antibodies will go form antigen antibody complexes with the bacteria, and bacteria will be opsonization take place, the bacteria will be dead. You will say, ma'am, then what is the problem? The bacteria is coming, causing tonsillitis, pharyngitis, the antibodies are formed and antigen antibody complexes are there, bacteria is gone, bacteria is dead. Right? So it is neutralized, whatever. What is the problem? The problem is that these antibodies are autoantibodies. What is actually happening? This bacteria, what is the name of the bacteria? The name of the bacteria is gas bacteria. Group A beta streptococcus bacteria. On the surface of the bacteria, few antigens are present, which are known as epitopes. Epitopes are the antigen present on the surface of the bacteria. Similar antigens are present on five human organs. In the body of the child, this child is having a heart, having a brain, having skin, having subcutaneous tissue, and having joints, right? So these are the five organs in the child. So all these five organs have epitopes. Epitopes which are same as that of bacteria. So these antibodies will get confused. The antibodies will think that this is also a bacteria. So they will cross-react with five organs in the child's body, in the human body. So basically these antibodies are autoantibodies. So whenever these antibodies, see the next diagram, can you see these antibodies which are formed against the bacteria, due to similarity in epitope, the same antibodies are cross-reacting. Can you see in the five diagrams? They are cross-reacting with the five organs, with the antigens on the five human organs. That's why these bodies are known as autoantibodies, right? So in the five organ, five diseases will happen. In the five organs, five diseases will happen. Now please mind that these diseases are caused by autoantibodies, not bacteria. It is not a bacterial disease, right? Bacteria are not causing these diseases. Human antibodies are acting as an autoantibody, and due to the mimicry between the antigens on these organs and the bacterial antigen, they are cross-reacting, right? So you can see the five diseases which are caused. What are the five diseases which are caused? In the heart, there is rheumatic heart disease. In the brain, there is Sydenham's chorea in the brain. So heart may rheumatic heart disease. Brain may Sydenham's chorea. On the skin, there is erythema marginatum on the skin. just below the skin, there is subcutaneous tissue. So in the subcutaneous tissue, there is subcutaneous nodules in the subcutaneous tissue, right? And in the joints, can you see the joints? In the joints, there is migratory polyarthritis. So these are the five diseases, and the five diseases together known as rheumatic fever. Now you tell me, what is rheumatic fever? First, everyone give me a thumbs up. Have you got it? What is rheumatic fever? Have you got it? So you can see this is rheumatic fever. So rheumatic fever is the umbrella term which includes five diseases. What are the five diseases? Involving five organs. It is a multi-system disease. It involves five organs. So how you will learn the five organs? Heart and brain are the two vital organs. Apart from it, there is skin. Just below the skin, there is subcutaneous tissue. And below the subcutaneous tissue, there are joints. So learn these are three organs. Skin, subcutaneous tissue, joints, heart and brain. So in the heart, it causes rheumatic heart disease. In the brain, it causes Sandham's chorea. In the skin, it causes erythema marginatum. In the subcutaneous tissue, it causes subcutaneous nodules. And in the joints, it causes migratory polyarthritis. Who is causing all these? Does bacteria causes all these? No, bacteria doesn't causes any of these. These all five lesions, five diseases in five organs is caused by antibodies. The antibodies are the autoantibodies. You got my point? So this is about the introduction of rheumatic fever. So can you tell me what is rheumatic fever? Can I say that rheumatic fever is a multi-system disease? Give me a thumbs up, yes or no? Yes, it is a multi-system disease. It is post-streptococcal. So it is always after the infection of the streptococcal gas bacteria, group A beta streptococcus bacteria. Without streptococcus, it cannot happen. And it is non-suppurative. By non-suppurative, I mean the bacteria is not coming in the lesion. Suppuration means pus. There is no pus in any of the five organs. There is no pus. Because bacteria is not coming in the five organs. These are non-suppurative inflammatory disease involving the five organs. Can I say that rheumatic fever is an acute disease? It is immunologically mediated disease because it is caused by autoantibodies. It is a multi-system disease that occurs a few weeks after gas bacteria pharyngitis. Can I say that? And these are the five organs involved. It's heart, joints, skin, subcutaneous tissue and brain. Everyone give me a thumbs up. Everyone. Jitni audience give me a thumbs up. Am I visible, audible? If I am visible, audible, please respond. Am I visible, audible? Please respond. Give me a minute to see your chat. Yes, I guess I am visible. So let me tell you the pathogenesis of the disease. As I have already discussed the pathogenesis, it is an autoimmune disease. It is not caused by the bacteria. It is not caused by the bacteria directly. It is caused by the autoantibodies. So there is a susceptible host. The susceptible host is a child, usually a child, right? Now the group A streptococcus infection is occurring. Group A beta streptococcus gas infection is occurring. And body is forming antibodies against that. So these antibodies are autoantibodies that are cross-reacting with five organs. Now name the antigen which is common in bacteria and these five organs. Can you name that antigen? I'm asking about this antigen. Can you see there is an antigen here? The antigen. So antigen on the bacteria and the same antigen on the five organ. Because of which these antibodies get confused. So the name of that antigen is NAG. N-A-G. N-acetylglycosamine. N-acetylglycosamine is the antigen which is common on the bacteria and the host tissue. Because of which these antibodies are cross-reacting. So can I say it is molecular mimicry and cross-reactivity? Can I say this terminology? Molecular mimicry and cross-reactivity. Who is doing molecular mimicry? The five tissue, the five organs in human, they are doing molecular mimicry with the bacteria. They are mimicry. You know, mimicry of the nakal utarna. So they have same antigen as that of bacteria. That's why, can I say these five organs are doing molecular mimicry with the bacteria? And that's why the antibodies are cross-reacting. They are formed against bacteria, actually. But now, after reacting with the bacteria, these antibodies are reacting with the five organs also. This is known as cross-reactivity. So what is the mechanism in one word? It is molecular mimicry and cross-reactivity. Give me a thumbs up if you got the meaning. So the term looks complicated, but it's very easy if you understand the meaning behind it. So molecular mimicry and cross-reactivity is the pathogenesis of rheumatic fever. So who is doing molecular mimicry? It is streptococcal antigen and the human endogenous molecule. They are doing molecular mimicry. And who is doing cross-reactivity? The autoantibodies are formed. You got it? So Fatima, Vaidehi, Ayush, Awesome, Imran, Kishore, shall I move ahead? Everyone? Yes? So coming on the Jones criteria. Jones is a person, he's a physician, he's a scientist who has discovered all this. So the five, so Jones criteria, there are five major Jones criteria and there are five minor Jones criteria that must be present in a patient, in a child in which you are giving the diagnosis of rheumatic fever. So what are the five major, what are the five minor Jones criteria? Let me start with five major Jones criteria. Jones is the name of the scientist, huh, who has given all these criteria. So five major, five minor, total 10 criteria, right? five major criteria are same, the five organs involved. The five major criteria are same as the five organs involved. So say in the heart, what is the name of the disease? Rheumatic heart disease in the heart. Say in the joints, it is polyarthritis. Actually, it is migratory polyarthritis. In the brain, it is Sydenham's chorea. In the skin, it is erythema marginatum. And in the subcutaneous tissue, it is subcutaneous nodules. I am going to teach you all five in detail, one by one. So I'm covering this topic not only from pathology, but from medicine also. So this topic occurs in two subjects, pathology, medicine. We are covering entirely from both subjects. Shall I move ahead? So I will teach treatment part also. That is, I'm including the complete integrated session. So medicine, pathology, from everywhere you will complete endocarditis, right? So these are the five major criteria. No problem in that, right? So you can see the five major criteria are the five main diseases. In the heart, rheumatic heart disease. In the brain, Sydenham's chorea. In the skin, erythema marginatum. In the subcutaneous tissue, it's subcutaneous nodules. And in the joints, it's migratory polyarthritis. These are five major criteria. What about MAP? So you can see the five major criteria in this diagram. Can you see the tonsils of a child? See, the tonsils contain pus. So the tonsils, the boy is having tonsillitis, pharyngitis, by group A beta streptococcus bacteria, right? And after having tonsillitis or pharyngitis, after a few days of it, the child presents with these five problems. This child is having these five problems. If you have trouble in learning the five major criteria, I don't have trouble. How I learn two major organs? That is, heart and brain are two vital organs in human. So in brain, it's Sydenham's chorea. In heart, it's rheumatic heart disease. After that, skin. Just below the skin, subcutaneous tissue. Or uske niche hai joints. I learn like that. So skin mein ho gaya erythema marginatum. Uske niche subcutaneous tissue mein, there is subcutaneous nodules. Or uske niche joints mein arthritis. But it is polyarthritis. Multiple joints are involved. And it is migratory. So migratory polyarthritis. But if you have trouble in learning, I have a mnemonic for you. So those who have trouble, the mnemonic is Jones itself. J-O-N-E-S. So J for joints. Joints se yaad aa jayega tumhe polyarthritis. O ko bana do heart. Make a heart of O. Right? So heart se yaad aa jayega carditis. Cardiac disease. That is rheumatic heart disease. N se ho jayega nodules. Subcutaneous nodules. E se ho jayega erythema marginatum in the skin. Or S se Sydenham's chorea. So what is the mnemonic? You can make the mnemonic Jones itself, the five criteria, the five major criteria. Make a heart of O. Instead of O, write down a heart. So these are the five criteria. So what are the five criteria? J for joints. It is polyarthritis in joints, migratory polyarthritis. Heart is carditis. It is pancarditis. N is nodules, subcutaneous nodules. E is erythema marginatum in the skin. And S is Sydenham's chorea in the brain. Everyone give me a thumbs up. Shall I move ahead? So that is the major criteria. What about minor criteria? There are five minor criteria also. As I have told you, there are five minor criteria. So whenever this child have tonsillitis or pharyngitis, at the same time this child have fever also, because it is caused by a bacteria. So whenever bacterial infection takes place in human body presents with fever. So fever is a minor criteria. Fever is a minor criteria, number one, right? Now I am going to tell you very important thing. Please mind it. Very important thing. In the joints. Joints in pathology is known as arthral. The word arthral means joints. Now there are two terminologies I am telling you. Inflammation of the joint, what does it known as? And pain in the joint, what does it known as? Right? Inflammation is known as arthritis. Arthritis. Itis ka matlab hota hai inflammation in pathology. And arthralgia. Arthralgia. Algia means hota hai pain. Everything in pathology is to just split the term. Actually, pathology, apart from a subject, it's a language, right? So you are learning a new language, right? In medical terminologies, right? So itis means inflammation and algia means pain and arthral means joints. So it is inflammation of the joints, arthritis, and pain in the joints is arthralgia. Why I'm explaining this all to you? So arthritis is a major criteria, one of the major Jones criteria. And arthralgia is one of the minor Jones criteria. Now you will never forget and you will never confuse, right? Because this is something where students make mistake, right? So wherever the students do mistake, now I just elaborate that point and highlight that point. So you will not do mistake at this point, right? So see the second criteria. I'm teaching you minor criteria right now. So I told you fever is the first criteria, minor criteria. Second is arthralgia. Don't get confused. In the major criteria, it was arthritis. If you see, it is arthritis. If you see, it's arthritis. And here, it's arthralgia. Right? Rheumatic fever is something that tends to recur again and again. That's why previous history of rheumatic fever is a minor criteria. If the child is having previous history, it is a minor criteria. Right? Now, take the blood sample of the child in a test tube. and the blood, look for three things. All three things will be raised. Look for ESR, it will be raised. Look for C-reactive protein, CRP, it will be raised. Look for WBC count, it will be raised. So in the blood, look for three things. What are the three things in the blood you are looking for? You are looking for ESR, you are looking for CRP, and you are looking for total WBC count. All will be raised. And this is all considered in one of the criteria, that is lab diagnosis. So on the lab diagnosis, you find the raise of ESR raised, CRP raised, C-reactive protein, and total WBC count raised is known as leukocytosis. So this is one of the minor criteria containing all three things, right? Do the ECG of the child. I'm saying now heart is involved. One of the major criteria is heart involvement. You know. So one of the major criteria, can you see, this is heart involved. Heart is involved in one of. So whenever heart is involved, if you do the ECG of the child, in the ECG you will find prolonged PR interval because there is valvular involvement, one of the valvular involvement. Give me a thumbs up. So these are the five minor criteria. Can you see in the child, five major, five minor, 5 + 5, total 10 Jones criteria. They are in front of you. They are in front of you. We will revise them. Don't worry. We will enumerate them again. Everyone first give me a thumbs up. Sufi, Shoheb, Kishore, have you got it? Anyone having any problem? Shall I move ahead? Okay. Now, I am teaching you revised Jones criteria which came in 2016. Right? So, there is a revision. These are the old Jones criteria which I taught you just now. Just now, I taught you the old one. So, 5 major, 5 minor. But there is a revision in that. There is a revision in that. So, what is the revision? So, there is some modification done that are known as revised Jones criteria. Now imagine you are a doctor now and any child coming to your clinic, you are a pediatrician, with the parents the child is coming. What is the complaint to the child? The child is having many of the major criteria fitting in the child and many of the minor criteria fitting in the child. So you have seen many major, many minor are fitting and you have a strong suspicion this child is having rheumatic fever because multi-organ involvement is there and many major and minor criteria are fitting in the child. Clinically also, lab diagnosis also, it is fitting. So you are asking the mother or you are asking the parents, does child have tonsillitis few days back before all these? And the parents are saying no, the child don't have tonsillitis. So after hearing no, would you like to label rheumatic fever in this child? No. If the child don't have tonsillitis, means bacterial infection, gas infection, group A beta streptococcal infection. If the child don't have this infection, instead, although iske baad bhi, if major and minor are present, we cannot label it as a rheumatic fever. For labeling any child as rheumatic fever, all major and minor should be present after tonsillitis. Without that, I cannot label. So, can it be possible that major are present, minor are also present, many of major and minor, but child don't have tonsillitis history, right? Or it is very subclinical and went unnoticed. The parents didn't notice it and the child didn't notice it. It can happen. So what you will do in that case? So that came in the revised Jones criteria. So revised Jones criteria says that apart from major, apart from minor, add a third category. That is gas infection confirmation. Confirm the gas infection without which major minor doesn't hold good. If only major minor are present and gas infection is negative, you cannot label it as rheumatic fever. So include that in criteria also. So the third category which comes in role here, the 5 major are same. The 5 minor are same. In the revised one, 8 minor ko hata diya. There are 4 minor only. Konsa hata diya? So you can yourself see fever is there, arthralgia is there, ECG pe PR interval prolongation is there, and lab diagnosis is there. But recurrent history of rheumatic fever is gone nowadays. It is not considered as a criteria. So you can say it's theek hai. There are the same major, the same minor. One of them is removed. Okay, so 5 major, 4 minor. But 3 additional criteria are added as the gas bacterial infection confirmation. What is gas? What is gas? Gas is group A beta streptococcus pyogenes. Yes, it is streptococcus pyogenes only. Group A beta streptococcus is streptococcus pyogenes only. You are absolutely right. Right? So that is gas infection. How you will do the confirmation? Imagine, Ayush, imagine a child is there in your clinic. You are a pediatrician for a while, you imagine that. And this is a child coming to your clinic with the parents, right? And many of the major criteria are fitting in the child, many of the minor criteria are fitting in the child. But parents are saying, we don't remember the child is having any tonsillitis in the last few weeks or last few days, we don't remember that. How you will confirm? How you want to confirm the gas infection in this child? There are 3 ways of confirming. Number one, do a throat swab. Do a throat swab. In COVID, we are doing the throat swab now. So take a swab, just take the swab from the throat and then the throat swab, culture it. In COVID, we are not doing the culture because it is a virus. But bacteria grows on culture plates. So what is the culture, specific culture for Streptococcus pyogenes? You may be knowing that in microbiology. So whatever blood agar and whatever agar, you just do the culture, right? So do a throat swab and confirm on the culture. Number one, that can be the possibility. Number two, take the blood sample of a child. Instead of doing throat culture, take the blood sample. In the blood sample, look for the antibodies. If bacteria is present, body may have formed antibodies against the bacteria. Look for the antibodies, that is known as serology. Which antibodies you will look for in the blood? You will look for anti-streptolysin O antibody and you will look for anti-DNase antibody. So these are the total three things are there. What are the three things? Do a throat culture, a throat swab and do the culture and look for the two antibodies. Anti-streptolysin O antibody and anti-DNase antibody. If any of them is positive, guess infection is confirmed. Either you got the throat culture positive on the culture, throat swab, or you found any of the antibody. You got my point. Now, my next question to you. What I have taught till now. So, let's revise Jones criteria. Let's revise Jones criteria. Can anyone of you help me in revising? Tell me the five major. I'm talking about revised Jones. The latest Jones 2016 modification. Tell me five major. Tell me four minor. And tell me three guess criteria. Guess confirmation criteria. So, I want you to tell me five major, four minor and three guess criteria. Can anyone of you write? Start writing in the chat box. Anyone of you, Sufi, Ayush, Fatima, Kishore, Shoaib, anyone? Yes. So, start with major. In the major, the five organs are involved. Can you name those organs? So, the first organ involved is the heart, right? The first organ involved is the heart. Am I back? Am I visible? Am I audible? Give me a minute to confirm if I'm back. If you can see me, can hear me. Am I back? I guess it's working. My battery was low, so I started charging it. Anyways, can I confirm? Can I continue now? I was teaching you the major, minor and the guess criteria. Are you people there? Kindly someone give me a thumbs up in the chat box if I'm visible, audible. Okay, thank you. Thank you for confirming. So the five major criteria are the five organs involved. The first organ is the heart. Second organ is the brain. Third organ is the skin. Fourth organ, just below the skin, there is subcutaneous tissue. And fifth organ, the joints. Can you tell me the name of the diseases in each of them? Can you tell me? So in the heart, it is rheumatic heart disease. In the brain, it is Sydenham's chorea. In the skin, it is erythema marginata. In the subcutaneous tissue, it is subcutaneous nodules. And in the joints, I want to hear from you. In the joints, is it inflammation of the joint or pain in the joint? It's inflammation of the joint is the major criteria. So I will say arthritis, itis, right? Coming on the minor criteria. Can you tell me the five minor criteria? Four minor criteria. One of them is removed in revision. So the first one is the fever. The child have fever because it is a bacterial infection. At the time of tonsillitis, the child may have high grade fever. So fever is a minor criteria. Arthralgia. Algia means pain. So it is pain in joints. It is a minor criteria. Fever, arthralgia. Lab diagnosis. In the lab, look for three things in the blood of the child. Look for ESR, look for CRP, look for WBC count. All of them will be raised. So lab diagnosis, yes. So that is one of the minor criteria. And do the ECG of the child. As heart is always involved in most of the cases, in the ECG, you will find prolonged PR interval because of the valvular involvement. Most commonly, mitral wall is involved. And most common presentation will be MR. That is mitral regurgitation. And that will lead to PR prolongation. So that will be a minor criteria. Coming on the guess criteria. There are three guess criteria as I have told you. If you have major, if you have minor, but no guess criteria, you cannot label the child as rheumatic fever. So you, for confirmation, there should be guess criteria. That is group A beta streptococcal infection confirmation. After that, major and minor should be there. So do the throat swab and culture it, throat swab, and look for the antibodies in the blood. The two types of the antibodies, anti-streptolysin O and anti-DNase antibody. That's it, right? Now, my next question to you. Out of five major, four minor, and three guess criteria, how many should be present in one child, one patient, so that you can label the child as a confirmed case of rheumatic fever? It is not that key, all five you will find in one patient. All five major, all four minor, all three guess. No. So, how many? Can you tell me the number of the major and minor? And guess criteria. So the answer is in front of you. Can you see? If only two major criteria are present in a child. Only two. Don't look for minor. Now it doesn't matter whether minor present or doesn't matter. Doesn't present. Any two major if present in child. Then don't look for the minor. If one of the major is present. Then look for the minor. Then along with one major. At least two minors should be present. So either two major or one major plus two minor. But in both situation, one of the gas criteria should be fulfilled. So that is within 3 weeks before this presentation, the child is having gas infection. That you have to confirm. So what is the answer here? The answer here is either two major or one major plus two minor. But both of them along with gas criteria. Gas is confirmed. Gas has to be done. It is unavoidable. Right? Can I move ahead? Yes, you are absolutely right. Shankdeep, Sufi, awesome, Fatima. Yes. So shall I go ahead? Yes, Fatima, echo will be needed. I will come on the investigation. I will tell you all the list of investigation and echo is one of the investigation. Absolutely right. So I am going to teach you all 5 major one by one. Let me start the first one, rheumatic heart disease. The first major which I will teach you in much, much detail. The remaining 4 major. Syndans chorea, erythema marginitum, subcutaneous nodules, and migratory polyarthritis. I will give you a little bit detail. But rheumatic heart disease is something you have to study in much detail. Right, let me start rheumatic heart disease, which is one of the major Jones criteria. Shall I start? Okay. In rheumatic heart disease, we have understood why the disease is happening. The disease is not happening because of bacteria. The disease is happening because of autoantibodies. Can you see these autoantibodies? So autoantibodies are formed. The antibodies are actually formed against the bacteria which is causing tonsillitis. Since the epitopes or antigens present on the bacteria, the similar epitopes or antigens are present on the heart also. The antibodies got confused and they are cross-reacting with the heart. And antigen-antibody reaction in the heart is leading to a disease known as rheumatic heart disease. Right? Now in rheumatic heart disease, in the heart, there are 3 layers. So endocardium, myocardium, pericardium. So on which layer these antibodies are coming and forming antigen-antibody bonds? On all 3 layers. The answer is all 3 layers. On endocardium also, on myocardium also, on pericardium also. So antigen-antibody reaction takes place in endo, myo, peri. So endocarditis, myocarditis, pericarditis, everything happen in rheumatic heart disease. In rheumatic heart disease, all 3 layers are inflamed. That's why, can I say in rheumatic heart disease, there is pancarditis. Pancarditis is the inflammation of all 3 layers. Pan ka matlab hota hai all. Right? So endocarditis, myocarditis, pericarditis, that is pancarditis. So there is pancarditis because all the layers of the heart is inflamed. Because the antigen, which is similar to that of bacteria, that antigen, M protein, is present on all 3 layers. So antibody will react with all 3 layers, causing inflammation of all 3 layers. You can see the diagram. In this diagram, you can see this is endocardium of the heart. Can you appreciate this one is the endocardium? Can you appreciate this is the thickened complete myocardium? The thickened myocardium from here to here. This is complete myocardium. Can you see the pericardium? This one is the pericardium. So all 3 layers will get inflamed. Give me a thumbs up. Now see, in this diagram, you can appreciate this is the tonsils of the child. In the tonsils, these are the bacteria. Can you see the bacteria in the chain? Because streptococcus occurs in chain. So beautiful diagram showing it is streptococcus. Because staphylococcus occurs in bunches. Streptococcus occurs in chains. So can you see these are the chains of the cocci? It is a streptococcus gas bacteria. It is causing pharyngitis. So whenever pharyngitis is there, you can see these are the beta cells converted into plasma cells forming antibodies. So can you appreciate the Y-shaped antibodies? If you zoom the diagram, you can see the Y-shaped antibodies. These Y-shaped antibodies are going to the blood. In the blood, it is going to the heart via blood. And after going in the heart, it is reacting with endocardium, myocardium, pericardium. That is pancarditis. Have you understood the meaning of this diagram? Shall I move ahead? Can you all see diagram on this page? A sketch diagram I have drawn for you. You can see the 3 layers of the heart. Endo, myo, peri. The red one is the endo. The black one is the myo. And green one is the peri. Now, this is the master diagram in which I will show you all the lesions in rheumatic heart disease. So the lesions in endo, the lesions in myo, the lesions in peri, I will draw in this diagram actually to show you the lesions. So that is how I am going to complete this diagram, and complete pancarditis is to be shown in this diagram. This is the master diagram. One more thing, I am revising, you have told you previously, there are heart walls. Can you see purple color I have drawn here? These are the walls of the heart. The walls of the heart contain only endocardium, no myo, no peri. So can I say endocardium is of 2 types? The endocardium present on the wall is valvular endocardium. And the endocardium which is present on rest of the heart, the 3-dimensional heart, the layers of the heart, it is known as mural endocardium. So 2 types of endocardium is there. Apart from the black one is the myocardium. And you can see the green one is the pericardium. Can you see? So endo, the 2 types of endo. So draw this flowchart. Don't read it behind. So I am teaching you endocarditis first. Then I will teach you myocarditis. Then I will teach you pericarditis. And everything I will draw in this master diagram. In the endocarditis, I am dividing it into 2 categories. Valvular, mural. Let's start endocarditis. First, let me finish endo, then myo, then peri. In this way, I will finish pancreatitis of the rheumatic heart disease. Shall I? In the endo, let me start valvular one. Let me start valvular one. So, I am teaching you valvular endocarditis. So, all now, remember every time again and again, I will not tell you the complete lesions, whether endo, myo, peri. In the endo, whether it is valvular, whether it is mural, all these lesions are not caused by bacteria. Bacteria is not coming to the heart and causing infection of these three layers. No, not at all. The antibodies are coming. So, it is the antigen antibody. It is the cross-reactivity of the autoantibody which is causing everything. So, imagine everything is caused by the antibodies, right? So, in the walls, due to the antibodies, some nodular lesions are formed. These are known as vegetations. What are vegetations in the heart? Vegetations are small nodules which are formed on the walls of the heart. What's the reason? See the diagram. Can you see the diagram? In this diagram, I have shown you the vegetations with this yellow dots. Can you see? These are the nodules. These are the nodules. Nodules. So why these are formed in the walls of the heart? What is the reason? The reason is antigen-antibody reaction. On the walls of the heart, some antigen is present which is common to that bacteria. That's why autoantibody is coming and reacting there. So antigen-antibody complexes are formed which are visible in the form of the nodules. And these nodules are known as vegetations or also known as verruca. Also known as verruca. Vegetations, verruca, one and the same thing. Now, vegetations and verruca are formed in valvular endocarditis. In valvular endocarditis, vegetations or verruca are formed. You tell me five things. Tell me the growth of these vegetations, whether they are single, multiple, soft, firm, sterile, bland. Tell me everything, the growth of this vegetation. Tell me the walls. There are four walls in the heart. Tell me the sequence, which is most commonly involved, second most common, third most common, least common. So sequence of the walls, right? On the walls, tell me the location, exact location of the wall where these nodules are formed. So tell me all these things, describe vegetation. Let's start vegetation, right? Let's start vegetation. So gross may, these vegetations are small. So I have told you that I am going to teach you four type of endocarditis. At the beginning of the lecture only, I taught you I am going to teach you four type of endocarditis in this session only. So the first endocarditis is rheumatic heart disease, which we are studying right now. The second I will teach you is Lippmann-Seck, that is SLE endocarditis. The third I will teach you is NBTE, that is non-bacterial thrombotic endocarditis. And in the end, I will teach you infective or bacterial endocarditis. You can see the size of the vegetation in all of them. In rheumatic heart disease, total pancreatitis is there. All layers are involved, but endo is a part of pancreatitis. Now, in the remaining three, only endocarditis will be there, right? So basically, in all of them, endocarditis is there. So whenever there's an endocarditis, vegetations will be formed on the wall. So vegetations is seen in all of them, but see the size, see the location, see the morphology of vegetation is different. So see the vegetations in rheumatic heart disease. Can you see? They are small, smallest among all. So they are small and they are multiple. They are small, they are multiple, and very good, they are sterile. Yes, yes, Shankdeep, they are sterile. Why they are sterile? Because there is no bacteria coming here and causing the vegetations. I have told you the reason for this vegetation is antigen-antibody complex formation. The antigen is a mimicry antigen with the bacteria. There is no bacteria. So that's why these vegetations are sterile. Yes. So can I say they are small? You have seen the diagram, all of them are small. They are multiple, they are warty, they are soft and firm, and they are sterile and bland, not infected. They do not contain bacteria. That is the gross description of these vegetation. Compare them with others. I'm going to teach you all one by one, don't worry, right? I will show you this diagram four times, right? Whenever I will teach you all type of endocarditis, and every time I will do the comparison. So these are the small and multiple and sterile one, right? You can see the real diagrams. The diagrams are from Robbins. You can see this. These are the vegetations. Can you appreciate on the walls? You can see corda tendineae in the walls of the heart. It is a diagram of the heart wall. Can you see? Now coming on the sequence. In the heart wall, how many walls are present in the heart? The four walls. You can see in this diagram, this is the left side of the heart. This is the right side of the heart. From the left side, this is aorta coming out. And from the right side, this is pulmonary artery coming out. Am I right? I guess. Right. On the left side, there is bicuspid wall or mitral wall. Right. Here, tricuspid wall on the right side. Here, on the aorta, aortic wall. And on pulmonary artery, pulmonary wall. Four walls are there. The two walls on the left side, the two walls on the right side. Two walls on the left side is mitral and aorta. These are left side. And two walls on the right side are tricuspid and pulmonary. Tricuspid and pulmonary are known as semilunar. Pulmonary and aortic are known as semilunar walls. Right. Now, what is the sequence here? In RHD, vegetations can be formed in any of them. But most commonly, they are formed over mitral. So, mitral is the most commonly involved, followed by aortic. So, M, A. M followed by A. So left side heart valves are involved common than right. On the right, the third one is the tricuspid. And last one is the pulmonary. So you can learn a mnemonic MATP. M-A-T-P. M-A-T-P is the mnemonic. So M is most common. Mitral followed by aortic, second most common. Tricuspid is the third most common. And pulmonary is not at all involved. Na ke barabar involved hoge? Hardly. We didn't found any case in which pulmonary vegetations are there. So least commonly involved. So we can say again that left heart valves are common involved as compared to right heart valves. Give me a thumbs up if you got it. So that is a sequence. So that is a sequence. You can see the percentage wise. Mitral alone is involved in most of the cases. Mitral plus aortic is involved. Then the third is tricuspid. And pulmonary is least commonly involved, less than 1% of the cases. Give me a thumbs up. So the mnemonic. So can you tell me the commonest wall involved? Answer is mitral. Can you tell me the second most common wall involved? These are all MCQs. Huh? We will do the practice MCQs. The second most common is aortic. Can you see the least common involved? The least common is pulmonary wall. The least common is the pulmonary. So you learn the mnemonic MATP. That's it. First most common, second most common, third most common, last or least most common. Right. Now, whenever talk about the most common. Let's talk about the most common. What is the most common? I told you. Most common is the mitral. So whenever, imagine on the mitral wall, imagine that on the mitral wall, whenever vegetations are formed, what will be the deformity? What will happen to mitral wall? Two possibilities are there. Either mitral stenosis will happen or mitral regurgitation will happen due to the vegetation's formation in the mitral wall, right? So both can happen. Both can happen. But regurgitation is more common than stenosis. So most common valvular deformity is MR. MR, that is mitral regurgitation. I guess you know the difference between stenosis and regurgitation. Give me a thumbs up. So that is the thing, right? And because of mitral regurgitation, you can hear murmurs on auscultation. So in the child, if you auscultate the child with a stethoscope, you can hear the murmurs. You can hear the murmurs of MR also, MS also, depending what is the wall involved, what is the deformity in that wall. Give me a thumbs up. Come on. Shall I move ahead? Now, till now, we have studied that all three. Yeah, in chronic one, MR is there. In acute one, yes. In chronic one, MS is there. In acute one, MR is there. But MR is more common than MS, Shandeep, absolutely right. MR is overall most common than MS. So, till now, we have seen that vegetations are formed. So, we have seen the gross of the vegetations. In the gross, we have seen the vegetations are small, they are multiple, they are sterile, they are bland. After that, we have seen the walls ka sequence. The sequence of the wall is MATP. We have seen this sequence. In M, more commonly MR followed by MS, right? Now I'm coming the location of the vegetation on the wall exactly. What do you mean by location? Okay, for this I have to again draw the diagram to explain you the location, what I mean by location. Please understand, now this topic is difficult. You see, this is the left side, this is the heart's right side. In the left side, bicuspid wall is there. Let me draw the two cusps. Can you see, this is one of the cusps, this is another cusp. Here tricuspid wall is there, so let me draw the three cusps. Here there are three cusps. I'm interested in mitral wall. This is mitral wall and this is bicuspid. We know that. What do you mean by the two cusps? Listen. Whenever the two cusps are separating from each other, the space is there. The wall is opening, I mean. So blood will come from auricle to ventricle. Right? And whenever the two cusps are closing, the wall is closing, no blood is coming from auricle to ventricle. We know that. So the two cusps, they are opening, they are closing. They are opening, they are closing. These are the two cusps. My two hands are the two cusps, you can imagine. So they are opening, they are closing. In this way, the blood is coming from auricle to ventricle in the cardiac cycle every time. I want to ask you, these are the two cusps. Can you imagine? These are the two cusps. So this is auricle and this is ventricle. So can I say the walls have two surfaces? One is auricular surfaces. The upper surface of the wall is auricular surface and the lower surface of the wall is ventricular surface. And this is the junction. This is the junction. So I want to ask you, where the vegetation is formed? On the upper surface, auricular surface, on the ventricular surface, lower surface, or junction. So in all four endocarditis, the location of the vegetations are formed on the wall. No doubt they are formed on the wall. But wall mein kaha? Where on the wall? Upper surface, auricular surface, lower surface, ventricular surface, or at the junction. The junction of the two walls. Where they are meeting. So what is the answer here? So in the first rheumatic endocarditis, they are formed at the junction. So let me draw the vegetations neither on the upper surface nor on the lower surface. They will be formed here at the junction. You got my point? Here on the junction they will be formed. On the junction they will be formed. Give me a thumbs up. You got it? So here they will be formed at the junction. At the junction where they meet. So at the junction the vegetations are formed. That is the location. So along the line of the closure or at the junction of the leaflets of cusp. So that is their exact location. You got my point? Give me a thumbs up if you got my point. This point was difficult. Yes or no? So can you see in this diagram, can you appreciate the two tusks? So in the two tusks, can you appreciate the vegetations are there at the junction? They are junction of the closure. They are present at the junction. Here, you can appreciate the two cusps and these are the vegetations at the junction. The vegetations at the junction. Multiple vegetations at the junction. Neither on upper nor on lower. It is at the junction. Please appreciate this point. Now, because the vegetations are present along the line of closure or at the junction, whatever you say, there is peculiar deformity in that wall. The wall look like a fish mouth. You know, these are the two cusps. Let me draw the two cusps of a wall. This is the one cusp of the wall. This is the another cusp of the wall. I'm saying the vegetations are formed at the line of the closure or at the junction, because of which it gives a fish mouth appearance. The appearance is known as fish mouth or buttonhole. What do you mean by fish mouth? Can you see it is looking like the mouth of a fish? Can you see? Have you seen the diagram of a fish? It is looking like the pouting mouth of a fish. Can you see it is looking like a pouting mouth of a fish? This abnormality is known as fish mouth appearance or buttonhole appearance. So please learn these catchy terms for MCQs. You got my point? You can see this is appearing as a fish mouth or buttonhole. Can I move ahead? Can I move ahead? See either yes or no. Have you got it? So what we have learned in that valvular endophagitis. What is the most common wall involved? Answer is mitral. In acute rheumatic carditis, as Shandeep was telling us, most common abnormality in acute and most common abnormality in chronic. So most common abnormality in acute is MR. And most common abnormality in chronic is MS. But overall most common is MR. If you want to pick one, it is MR. Least common wall involved is pulmonary. The mnemonic is MATP. We have learned that. Shall I move ahead? Microscopy, please, you can leave it. Not important. So we are done with valvular endocarditis. In valvular endocarditis, vegetations are formed. Describe vegetations. So they are small, they are multiple, they are sterile, they are soft and firm. Most common mitral wall. The mnemonic is MATP. And they are present at the line of the junction, because of which fish mouth buttonhole deformity is there. And most common abnormality in the mitral wall is MR. So this is the summary of vegetation. Any question can be asked on vegetation and you are prepared for that. Right. So in the endocarditis, we are done with valvular endocarditis. As I've told you, there are two endocarditis. One is present over the wall, is the valvular one. The rest of the endocarditis in the chambers, in the four chambers of the heart is mural endocarditis. So tell me the abnormality there. Again, the abnormality is due to antigen-antibody reaction. So can you see this diagram? In this diagram, I have shown you the heart walls. On the heart walls, you can appreciate the vegetations on the heart walls. So this is valvular abnormality seen in rheumatic heart disease. That is vegetations. Now, apart from this endocardium, can you see the red color everywhere? Appreciate the red color everywhere. This red color is the mural endocardium. So mural endocardium is the endocardium over the chambers of the heart. So among the four chambers, there are four heart chambers, right? So among the four heart chambers, the left heart chamber, the left auricle on the posterior wall of the left auricle, there is an area on which antigen antibody reaction take place. Because this area contains the same antigen as that of bacteria, that's why antibody are coming and cross-reacting here, causing this area wrinkled, thickened area. This area is known as McCallum patch. So in mural endocardium, McCallum patch is formed, right? Where is the McCallum patch? What is the location? The location is left auricle. See the diagram specifically. It is the left side and it is the auricle, not ventricle. Left auricle. Now left auricle have four walls: anterior, posterior, medial, lateral. Medial is interauricular septum. So it is on the posterior wall. It is on the posterior wall of the left auricle, just above the mitral wall. That is the exact location. So what is McCallum patch? Can you describe McCallum patch? Yes. So McCallum patch is formed on the endocardium of the posterior wall of the left auricle, just above the posterior leaflet of the mitral wall. Right. It is a map-like area which is roughened and thickened and wrinkled part due to antigen-antibody reaction. Everyone give me a thumbs up. Have you got it? So these are the two things we have seen. So this diagram is a complete diagram showing endocarditis. The two problems in the endocarditis. What is the problem in valvular endocarditis? What is the problem in mural endocarditis? Both is shown in this diagram. In the valvular endocarditis, we have vegetations. You can appreciate the vegetation. In the mural endocarditis, there is McCallum patch. It is shown in this diagram. So this is the summary of the endocarditis. In this diagram also, you can see the two things. Appreciate the walls. appreciate the vegetations over the walls. The vegetations over the walls is vegetations, that is bulbular endocarditis. Appreciate McCallum patch. The McCallum patch is in mural endocardium in the left auricle, a wrinkled thickened area. Right. So this is the summary of the endocarditis. Now I will start myo and peri. So endocarditis is done. In rheumatic heart disease, all three layers of the heart are involved, that is pancarditis. The first layer was the endocardium, endocarditis. Endocarditis is of two types, valvular and mural, right? Valvular and mural. So in valvular, vegetations are formed. We have described the vegetations. In mural, there is McCallum patch formation, right? So we have seen the details. You know the location of McCallum patch. Coming on myocardium. What will happen in the myocardium? In the myocardium also, you can see the diagram, nodules will be formed. In the myocardium also, the nodules will be formed, but these nodules in the myocardium are not vegetations. The nodules in the myocardium which are formed, again, this is due to antigen-antibody reaction. These nodules are known as Eschkoff nodules. It is in the same way the nodules form over the endocardium, over the vegetations, but these are known as Eschkoff nodules. Now, what are Eschkoff nodules? Eschkoff nodules are granuloma. You know what is a granuloma? It is a chronic inflammation. Due to the chronic inflammation, nodular lesions are formed, which are known as granulomas. So all Eschkoff nodules are granulomas. Let me zoom the diagram of one of them to show you the structure of one of the Eschkoff nodule. Shall I? Okay, see the next diagram. In the next diagram, I have zoomed one of the Eschkoff nodule. In this, you can see one of the Eschkoff nodule. One. All of them have the same structure. So in this diagram, so let me draw this diagram on the next page. In this diagram, you can see a Eschkoff nodule. The center of the Eschkoff nodule have necrosis, fibrinoid necrosis. There are five types of necrosis in general pathology, chapter 1. What are the five types of necrosis? Coagulatory necrosis, caseous necrosis, liquefactor necrosis, fat necrosis, fibrinoid necrosis. So the fibrinoid necrosis is present at the center of all Eschkoff nodules. So let me draw the center. The center is having fibrinoid necrosis. Around the center, two types of cells are present. What are the two types of cells present around the center? The first type of cells are giant cells, having multiple nucleus. Few giant cells are there. So these are known as Eschkoff cells. Eschkoff cells are the cells which are giant cells. They have multiple nucleus. The second type of cells here are anti-Eschkoff cells. So what is the shape of the nucleus in them? Two type of nucleus is there. If you see from front, the nucleus is owl eye appearance, looking like the eye of an owl, right? So these owl eye, and if you see from the side, the same nucleus will have caterpillar appearance, caterpillar. So these are the same cells. Some of them will have caterpillar, and if you cut the caterpillar and see from the front, it will be owl eye. So that is the same cell. These are not two types. All the blue cells shown here, these blue cells are anti-Eschkoff cells. Anti, all of them. So they have two type of nucleus. If you see from the front, it is caterpillar. If you see from the side, it is owl eye. That is the two type of nucleus in them. So same nucleus, the view is different, I can say, right? So these are anti-Eschkoff cells. So in the center, fibrinoid necrosis is there. The fibrinoid necrosis is surrounded by two type of cells, the Eschkoff and anti-Eschkoff. Give me a thumbs up, right? Now surrounding this, two more type of cells are there. Three more type of cells are there. Surrounding this, few of the lymphocytes are there. Let me draw few lymphocytes. These all are lymphocytes. You know what are lymphocytes. Surrounding this, few plasma cells are there. Can you see? These all are plasma cells. And surrounding this, outermost is the fibroblast, which will form fibrosis. Outermost is the fibroblast. So this is the diagram of Eschkoff nodule, which is the hallmark feature of myocarditis. In myocarditis, multiple nodules are formed. All these nodules are known as Eschkoff nodules. Eschkoff nodules are granulomas. What is the structure of a granuloma? In the center, fibrinoid necrosis is there. It is surrounded by five type of cells. The most important cells are Eschkoff and anti-Eschkoff, which are unique for this. Eschkoff cells are giant cells. They have multiple nucleus inside them. And anti-Eschkoff cells are the circular cell, have only one nucleus. But the shape of the nucleus is typical. Either the shape of the nucleus is owl eye or the shape of the nucleus is caterpillar. Caterpillar. Yes, excellent, Shankdeep. It is caterpillar. So not only caterpillar, but owl eye is also important. That depends on the view, on from which view you are looking at the nucleus. Give me a thumbs up. Yeah, apart from it, lymphocyte, plasma cells, and fibroblast. Outermost are the fibroblast. So this is the diagram of a Eschkoff nodule. Have you got it? This is the diagram. Now the two type of unique cells, which I taught you here, the two unique cells, Eschkoff and anti-Eschkoff. What are they actually? Both of them are macrophages which are modified. Both of them are modified macrophages. In Eschkoff cells, macrophage become modified and the nucleus become multiple macrophages fuse with each other, and that's why they become giant cells. And anti-Eschkoff cell, macrophage become modified, there's change in the shape of the nucleus, it become anti-Eschkoff. So basically both of them are macrophages. You got my point? Give me a thumbs up if you got it. Come on. So what is myocarditis? So we are done with endocarditis. We started myocarditis. In myocarditis, the hallmark feature is Eschkoff bodies. So grossly, multiple nodules are formed. So all these nodules are known as Eschkoff bodies, and that is the pathognomonic feature of complete RHD, right? It is present in the myocardium. You can see the structure. They are the granulomas. They have a central fibrinoid necrosis. It is the fibrinoid necrosis present at the center. It is surrounded by Eschkoff and anti-Eschkoff cells. And it is surrounded by lymphocyte, plasma cell and fibroblast. So total five type of cells are there. Enumerate the five type of cells. None of the cells is neutrophil. So neutrophils or polymorphs are absent in Eschkoff body. It is an MCQ. Give me a thumbs up. Right. So that is the Eschkoff bodies. This is the structure you can see of each Eschkoff body. This is the structure given in the books. Can you appreciate the same diagram? See the center yellow color. This is the fibrinoid necrosis. Surrounding it, see the cells. Can you see the cells? Can you see this is a giant cell having three nucleus, multiple nucleus. That's why it is the Eschkoff cell. This one is the Eschkoff cell, right? See these cells, the smaller one, these red color cells. Let me zoom it. Can you see it? Here, the nucleus is owl eye, and here, the nucleus is caterpillar, right? So both of them are anti-Eschkoff cells, right? And surrounding it, lymphocyte, plasma cells, and fibroblast are there. So Eschkoff cells and anti-Eschkoff cells. Both of them are modified macrophages. It is an MCQ. Eschkoff cells are basically giant cells having multiple nucleus because multiple macrophages fuses with each other to form one Eschkoff cell. Anti-Eschkoff cell, the macrophages have the nucleus either caterpillar or owl eye. So it depends from where you are looking. If you are looking from the side, it is like this. And if you are cutting and looking from the front, it will be like this. So caterpillar and owl eye. Have you got it? The same diagram from some other book. You can appreciate here, this is a giant cell. So name the cell. Can you see multiple nucleus? Can you name this cell? Can you name this cell? This cell is Eschkoff cell because it is a giant cell. Yes or no? And can you see these two cells? See this cell. See the nucleus. It is owl eye. Ulluki ankh. And can you see this cell? Caterpillar. Right? Both these cells are anti-Eschkoff cell. Appreciate it. Give me a thumbs up. These are the real diagrams from some biopsies. You can appreciate this is an Eschkoff cell. This is an anti-Eschkoff cell. These are the real diagrams you all can appreciate here. Can you see? This is owl eye appearance, right? So, can you see this is Eschkoff cell, giant cell is there. So, can you see this is caterpillar appearance? Appreciate the cells with caterpillar nucleus. Can you appreciate the cells with caterpillar nucleus? Appreciate. Appreciate it. Have you got it? Have you got it? Right. So, Ayush, you are asking, can we also have giant cells of epithelial origin? Giant cells of epithelial origin. No, you are confusing, I guess, with epithelioid origin. It is not epithelial, Ayush. It is epithelioid. Actually, what happens now? Let me start from the beginning. If you are asking, then let me tell you everything. So, this is the bone marrow. Inside the bone marrow, all the cells are formed. So, WBCs are also formed in the bone marrow. So, this is the hematopoietic stem cell giving rise to all cells. RBC, WBC and platelet. WBCs are of five types. So, one of the type is monoblast. Monoblast, right? Monoblast give rise to monocyte. So in the bone marrow, monoblasts are present. Once monoblast converted into monocyte, one of the WBC, right? That monocyte will come in the blood, right? So this is monocyte coming in the blood. So monoblast present in bone marrow. Monocyte come in the blood. After that, they convert into monocyte and they come in the blood. Monocyte once leave the blood and come in the tissue. So these are known as macrophages. These are known as macrophages, right? Now this is a macrophage. Macrophage in presence of interferon gamma get converted, it become modified and it get converted into epithelioid cell, not epithelial. You are getting confused, I guess. Epithelioid cell. So epithelioid cell is a modified macrophage only. Now multiple epithelioid cells fuse with each other and they form giant cell. Now you can see the complete sequence. I guess there is no confusion in that. So let me summarize everyone here. So monoblast present in the bone marrow. After that, it converts into monocyte and go in the blood, right? Monocyte leave the blood and come in the tissue known as macrophage. Macrophage in presence of interferon gamma get modified and convert into epitheloid cell. Multiple epitheloid cell fuses with each other and they form giant cells. So I can say giant cell are epitheloid in origin, Ayush, not epithelial. Shall I move ahead, right? So they are epitheloid, you are right. They are epitheloid in origin, right? You are absolutely right. So can I move ahead? So we are done. What we have done till now? Till now, we are studying rheumatic heart disease, which is pancarditis. So in pancarditis, we have finished endocarditis, we have finished myocarditis. Now it's time to start pericarditis. It's time to start pericarditis, yes or no? Endocarditis is of two types, valvular and mural. So what is the summary of endocarditis? In valvular endocardium, vegetations are formed. In mural endocardium, mecallum patches formed. In myocardium, Eschkoff bodies are formed. Now what about pericarditis? Who will tell me what will happen in pericarditis? Right. So let me go ahead. So in pericardium, what is pericardium? Normal pericardium. In normal pericardium, this is the heart. These are the four chambers of the heart. Heart is surrounded in a space known as pericardial space. This is the pericardial sac, and this space, a small space, this space is known as pericardial space. What is present in pericardial space? In pericardial space, small amount of fluid is present in normal healthy individuals. Small amount of watery fluid is present. It is known as pericardial fluid. This pericardial fluid is very small in amount. It is thin, watery in consistency. This is the healthy pericardial fluid present in the pericardial space, in the pericardial sac, right? So this is normal. But when this person, if it is a child and this is having rheumatic heart disease, so due to antigen-antibody reactions in the pericardium, the fluid present in the pericardium become fibrinous in consistency. Fibrinous. What do you mean by the term fibrinous? The word fibrinous is thready. It becomes thready. Hindi mein kahun to dhagedar. So fluid, instead of becoming thin, watery in consistency, it becomes thready in consistency. The word thready is fibrinous, and the disease is known as fibrinous pericarditis. So basically, this patient will have fibrinous pericarditis. What do you mean by that? Technically, what do you mean by that? So in the pericardium of this child, a fluid will come. Normally, it is thin watery fluid. It is replaced by a fluid which is thready in consistency. The word thready is to be picked up here. The thready meaning in pathology is fibrinous, right? Now, it will give the heart a bread and butter appearance. What do you mean by bread and butter? I will explain you in this diagram. What is bread and butter? Can you see this diagram? You all can see this diagram. You can see the pericardial sac. This is myocardium. This is pericardium. The space between myo and peri is known as pericardial space. Can you see the pericardial space? Can you all see the thready fluid? The threads are seen. Dhagedar fluid, thready fluid. This is fibrinous pericarditis. This is fibrinous pericarditis. It is happening. Now listen, imagine the child is dead. This child is dead. The rheumatic heart disease child is dead. So what we are doing the autopsy. See in this diagram also, first see in this diagram. Can you see the outermost green covering? The outermost green covering is the pericardium, and see the thready fluid inside that. The thready fluid inside that is fibrinous pericarditis, right? Now I'm explaining you bread and butter appearance. Imagine this child is dead and we are doing the autopsy of this child. Autopsy of this child. In the autopsy, what we will do? We will take the heart out. The heart of the child is taken out, right? After taking the heart, there are three layers inside the heart. So how we open the heart? First, we will take a scissor. Can you see that here is a scissor? And we will cut the pericardial sac. Pericardial sac is a thin membrane. So we will cut with a scissor. And we will separate the pericardium from myocardium. Myocardium is very thick. We have to use a scalpel to cut the myocardium. But pericardium is cut with a scissor. So this is the scissor, and I am cutting the pericardium from everywhere. And the below the pericardium, I can see the myocardium here. I want to see the fluid between pericardium and myocardium. Now please understand. Have you ever had a bread and butter sandwich? Yeah, it's very tasty, delicious. Yes or no? So there are two pieces of bread. These are the two pieces of bread, and in between there is butter. So this is the butter. Have you ever tried to separate the two slices of bread from each other in opposite direction? Have you ever tried? If not, do it. So you can see the threads of the butter in between. Can you see the thready butter? The threads of the butter in between. The same way, whenever the child is dead and we are performing the autopsy, we are taking the heart out and we are cutting the pericardium and separating the myocardium from it. So pericardium and myocardium are the two slices of the bread, and the fluid between them is the butter. You caught my point? So can you see in this diagram? Beautiful diagram from Robles. Can you see? This is pericardium. Please appreciate, this is pericardium. We have cut with the scissor and separating. and can see this is myocardium inner. We are trying to separate pericardium and myocardium, and if you zoom the diagram, you can appreciate the thready appearance. This is the butter. That is fibrinous pericarditis. So we see fibrinous pericarditis. This appearance is known as bread and butter. Have you got the meaning of bread and butter? Bread and butter appearance. We are trying to separate the two slices of the bread, and we see the butter in between in the form of the thready pericarditis, fibrinous pericarditis. So I guess we are done. So this is the final summary. This is the final summary of rheumatic heart disease. Everyone give me a thumbs up. Yes, fibrinous pericarditis is seen in one of the type of acute inflammation. There are many type of pericarditis. Fibrinous is one of them. So there is serous, there is purulent, there is hemorrhagic. Fibrinous is one of them. Shantideen, absolutely right. Have you got it? Everyone give me a thumbs up. This is the summary. I will show you the master diagram now. So this is the master diagram I'm going to show you. First, see the summary. What is the summary? In rheumatic heart disease, pancarditis is there. Endo, myo, peri. In endomyocarditis, the two things are there, valvular and mural. So in valvular endocarditis, vegetations are there. Describe everything about vegetations. They are small, they are multiple, they are warty, they are soft, they are friable. Most common, they are in mitral wall. The mnemonic is MATP. Least common, they are pulmonary wall. They are present at the line of the junction. They give fish mouth or buttonhole abnormality. And most common deformity is MR. Right? That is everything about vegetation. In mural endocardium, a wrinkled patch is formed. McCallum patch. Give the location of McCallum patch. It is present in left auricle. On the posterior wall of the left wall, auricle. Just above the mitral wall. That is the exact location. Come on, myocardium. Eschkoff bodies are formed. Tell me the composition of Eschkoff bodies. They are granulomas. In the center, fibrinoid necrosis is there, surrounded by five type of cells. You know the five type of cells. The most important are Eschkoff and anti-Eschkoff cells, and both of them are modified macrophages, and you know their specialty. You know their structure diagram. Coming on pericarditis, in the pericarditis fluid, normal fluid is thin watery, that is replaced by thready fluid known as fibrinous pericarditis. And this gave heart bread and butter appearance. So this is the summary of rheumatic heart disease. And this is the final diagram I can show you. In the final diagram, please everyone appreciate the two endocarditis, that is vegetation on valvular endocarditis, McCallum patch on, this is vegetations you can see on valvular, this is McCallum patch on mural endocarditis. So this is the summary of endocarditis. In the myocardium, please everyone appreciate the Eschkoff nodules in the myocardium. So this is myocarditis. And in the pericardium, please everyone appreciate the fibrinous pericarditis in the pericardium. So endo, myo, peri, the pancarditis is in front of you. This is the master diagram. Now I'm having a question. So there are many things. In the endocardium, two things are there. In myocardium, one thing is there. In pericardium, one thing is there. That is finally pancarditis is there. But what is the pathognomonic feature? Pathognomonic feature is only one. What is pathognomonic among this all? What is pathognomonic? Pathognomonic feature is one for the disease. So what is the pathognomonic feature of rheumatic heart disease? What is pathog? So Eschkoff bodies. So answer is Eschkoff bodies. Eschkoff bodies is the pathognomonic feature, that is the most specific characteristic feature. Vegetations can occur in many other diseases also. McCallum patch can also occur in other diseases. Fibrinous pericarditis also occur in other diseases. But Eschkoff bodies, they are specific. They do not occur in other diseases. That's why this one is the pathognomonic feature, which is very important MCQ. Everyone give me a thumbs up. Everyone. So I am, as I've told you in this lecture, I am going to teach you the four type of endocarditis one by one. We are done with the first one, rheumatic endocarditis. So what we have learned in this endocarditis, can you tell me the summary? Here the vegetations are small, they are warty, they are firm, they are friable, they are along the line of the closure, that is junction, they are sterile, right? And they are seen in rheumatic fever, it is a part of rheumatic fever. That is about the endocarditis. I'm not telling you myo and peri, but it is pancarditis, you know. So, okay, I would like to launch some polls here. I am done in the rheumatic fever. I am done with out of the five Jones major criteria, one Jones major criteria is over. That is rheumatic heart disease ka pancarditis is over. Pancarditis is over. Then I will teach you other four major criteria of the Jones criteria and rheumatic fever. And then I will come on other endocarditis. Everyone give me a thumbs up. Before that, there are few questions based on rheumatic heart disease. Are you people interested for question? I will launch the questions only if you are ready to answer it. Right? So you have to give me the answer in the chat box. Right? This is the first question in front of you. Read the question. Let me see your chat on the mobile also. Give me a thumbs up. Give me a minute to open your chat. Okay? I can see your chat right now. Yes. So let me read the question. There is a 10-year-old boy, Pappu, who has died of rheumatic fever. The diagnosis is rheumatic fever. So all can be seen on the autopsy except, the question is except. So what is not seen on autopsy? So what is not a feature of rheumatic fever? Ashcroft nodules, does it seen or not seen? Rupture of caudate and tinea, does it seen or not seen? McKellen patch, yes or no? Fibrinous pericarditis, yes or no? So let's crack this question. Ashcroft nodules are seen in myocarditis. McKellen patch is seen in mural endocarditis. And fibrinous pericarditis is seen in pericarditis. It is a pancarditis. But rupture of caudate and tinea is not a feature of rheumatic fever. That's why my answer is B, because except was asked in the question. So everyone, Shankdeep, Kishore, Vaidehi, Ayush, Fatima, Shohei, you all are right. Very good. I want everyone to participate. Come on. Very good. Correct answer here is B. You all are right. This is the next question in front of you. And yes, you all can see the question. What are anti-Ashcroft cells? What are anti-Ashcroft cells? The four options are in front of you. Can you tell me the correct answer? Are they modified macrophages? Are they modified neutrophils? Are they modified B cells? Are they modified RBCs? So yes, again, very good. So Kishore, Vaidehi, Shankdeep, Mushin, Ayush, Fatima, very good. So correct answer, they are modified macrophage. Yes, yes, comedy, very good. So correct answer here is A, it is modified macrophage. I'm changing the question for you. Instead of anti-Ashcroft cells, I'm asking Ashcroft cells. What is your answer now? Ashcroft cells. Options are same, A, B, C, D. What is your answer now? Show him what is the answer now? Still the answer is A. So Ashcroft and anti-Ashcroft both are modified macrophages. So whether Ashcroft is asked or anti-Ashcroft is asked, how does it matter? The answer remains A only. Very good, very good. The answer remains A only. So correct answer here is A. Let me move to the next question. So which of the following cell is not seen in Ashcroft bodies? In Ashcroft bodies, in the structure, I told you, in the center, there is fibrinoid necrosis in the center. It is surrounded by five types of cells. You know the five types of cells surrounding it. So tell me which cell is not present. Which cell is not present in Ashcroft body? So the options are in front of you. Giant cells, Ashcroft cells, fibroblast and polymorphonuclear cells. You all are right. Kishore, Shandeep, Ayush, Fatima, Vaidehi, very good. Shohei, very good. Correct answer is neutrophil. Neutrophils or polymorphonuclear cells are not a part of Ashcroft body. Ashcroft body structure. So in Ashcroft body, the five type of cells, out of the five, two are made. Ashcroft and anti-Ashcroft. What are Ashcroft cells? They are giant cells. And what are anti-Ashcroft cells? They are macrophages with not giant cell having one nucleus only. But the shape of the nucleus is typical. Either it is owl-like or it is caterpillar depending on the view from which we are looking at. And these are the Ashcroft, anti-Ashcroft, then lymphocyte, then plasma cell, then fibroblast. Now look at the options. Look at the options. So giant cell is the Ashcroft cell only. Ashcroft cell is the Ashcroft cell. Fibroblast is also present, but neutrophil is absent. So correct answer is D and you all are right. Very good. The correct answer here is D. I am moving to the next question. It is the next question in front of you. Please tell me the answer. Most common valve involved in mitral in rheumatic fever. So the four options are in front of you. Is it mitral valve, aortic valve, pulmonary valve, tricuspid valve? I have told you the mnemonic. What is the mnemonic? What is the sequence of involvement of the valve? What is the sequence of involvement of the valve? It's an easy question. Always learn the mnemonic MATP, M-A-T-P. So this is the first most common, second most common, third most common and least common. Right. So answer, of course, here the answer is mitral and you all are right. Instead of most common, if I ask second most common, answer will become aortic. If I ask least common, answer automatically will become pulmonary. So depending what we have asked, the answer can vary. Absolutely right, Shankdeep, Kishore, Mushin, Fatima, Ayush, Padma Sai, Shoheb, everyone is right. Very good. The correct answer here is A. The next question, okay. I have just asked this question to you. You tell me the answer. Valve which is not involved in rheumatic fever. Which valve is not involved? Which valve is not involved? Not involved means least common involved. By not involved, if you are getting confused, you may consider the question as least common involved. One and the same thing. Not involved, it is least common involved. So the mnemonic, the same mnemonic apply, M-A-T-P. So mitral followed by aortic followed by tricuspid. So least is pulmonary. It is never involved. Less than 1% the cases are there. So correct answer is C and everyone is right. Very good. Very good. Excellent. Coming to the next question. Ashcroft bodies are seen in, I guess it is a very easy question. Ashcroft bodies are seen in which layer? The three layers. Is it seen in rheumatic myocarditis? Is it seen in rheumatic arthritis? Is it seen in bacterial endocarditis? Is it seen in mesenteric endocarditis? Yes. So, where does it seem? I guess the question is very easy. Of course, Ashcroft bodies are the pathognomonic feature the specific or characteristic feature of rheumatic myocarditis. Yes, everyone is right. It was an easy question. Easy question. So next question. The next question is also very easy. I guess everyone will be right in this question also. McKellum patch is diagnostic feature of which disease? So tell me the disease. So is it infective endocarditis, rheumatic endocarditis, MI or TOF, teratology of palate? Currently, you find these questions very easy and you may be thinking that why I'm launching all these questions. But once your all 19 subjects will be over now, then the same question looks difficult to you, right? Currently, the question is easy because just now I taught you and just now I'm launching the poll. So it is in your temporary memory or permanent, you cannot differentiate it. But after a long run, after maybe 1 year, 2 year, 3 year, if I launch the same question, you will get confused. So put it in your permanent memory, right? So McKellum patch, of course, the answer is B and you all are right. It is in rheumatic endocarditis. My next question in the same, which endocarditis? Is it valvular or mural? In which endocarditis it is seen? McKellum patch. In which endocarditis it is seen? Valvular. Yes, Kishore, it is mural endocarditis. Very correct. So correct answer is B. More better question was, tell me the chamber of the heart in which McKellum is seen. The four options are right auricle, right ventricle, left auricle, left ventricle. So what is the correct answer? What is the correct answer? In which chamber it is seen? So it is a better question, I guess. Yes? So what is the correct answer here? Very good. Very good, Vedahi. So of course it is left auricle and everyone else is also right. It is left auricle. Very good. So here the answer is B. Coming to the next question. What is the question? I'm asking characteristic feature of rheumatic carditis. Is it pericarditis, endocarditis, myocarditis or pancarditis? What will be the characteristic feature? Yes, Ayush, exactly. Yes, Shandeep, the exact location is posterior wall of the left auricle just above the mitral cusp. Yes, so what is the characteristic feature here, would you like to say, for rheumatic carditis? Is it peri, endo, myo or pan? We all know it is pancarditis. So pancarditis is involvement of all three layers. That is the hallmark feature of rheumatic carditis. So correct answer here is of course D. Coming to the next question. The next question is in front of you. The most characteristic histological finding of acute rheumatic carditis. The four options are in front of you. I am saying the most characteristic. All will happen in rheumatic carditis. I know that. But I am asking the characteristic one. Is it fibrinous pericarditis which is characteristic? Is it vegetation on the mitral wall which is characteristic? Eschoff bodies in the myocardium, is it characteristic? Or increased vascularity of the walls, is it characteristic? So I say all four are correct. But if you ask me the pathognomatic feature, characteristics means pathognomatic, that is only one. So specific feature is Eschoff bodies. Yes, you all are right. Yes. So Kishore, Shandeep, Fatima, Mushin, Ayush, Ashish, Vedahi, everyone is right. So correct answer here is C. Very, very good. Very good. This is the next question. Now this is tricky one. This one is tricky, right? I'm asking the exudate in rheumatic fever. Tell me the nature of exudate in rheumatic fever. Is it serous? Is it purulent? Is it fibrinous? Or is it myomatous? What do you mean by exudate? Exudate is the fluid which is filled in the cavities. That is the definition of exudate. So here pericardial effusion is there. I've told you pericardial effusion is there. The thin serous fluid in the pericardium is replaced by fibrinous fluid, that is the thread. So you all are correct here also. The answer is C, because of fibrinous pericarditis. Because of fibrinous pericarditis, right? So correct answer here is C. Shall I move ahead? Now tell me the pathognomatic feature of acute rheumatic fever. It's a repeat question, I guess, with the different options. I'm asking pathognomatic feature. Is it pericarditis, myocarditis, mitral stenosis or Eschoff nodules? Yes. What is the pathognomatic feature? Who will tell me? The pathognomatic feature is the Eschoff nodules. So we have done this question previously also, but the options may be different. So this question is repeated in many exams in your previous year question papers in different forms. Right? Okay, let me move other. Yeah. Tell me McKellum patch, usually located in which chamber of the heart? I've already asked this question to you. The four chambers are in front of you. Right auricle, left ventricle, right ventricle. So I guess everyone knows the answer. You have already answered it. So the correct answer here will be left auricle. We already know the exact location. Left auricle mein ye kahan pe hota hai. Yes, you all are right. The correct answer here will be B. Absolutely right. Right? So it will be the left auricle. This is the next question in front of you. In rheumatic fever, now it is a tricky question. Don't rush. I'm warning, don't rush. In rheumatic fever, fibrinoid necrosis occurs in which layer? Fibrinoid necrosis occurs in which layer? Fibrinoid necrosis occurs in myocardium, pericardium or endocardium. In which layer? Collisions is, you know, vestigial option. So in which layer it occurs? In which layer it occurs? I'm asking fibrinoid necrosis. I'm asking fibrinoid necrosis. So many of you got confused. Many of you got confused. Many of you got confused. Yes. यही मैं चाहती थी दैट यू सो मैनी सो द यू नो द कंफ्यूजन इज बिटवीन ए एंड सी मैनी ऑफ यू आर सेइंग ए इज द करेक्ट आंसर मैनी ऑफ यू आर सेइंग शोएब इज सेइंग सी शंखदीप इज सेइंग सी किशोर इज सेइंग सी एंड मैनी अदर्स आर सेइंग बी आल्सो सो व्हाट इज द करेक्ट ए और सी व्हाट इज द करेक्ट आंसर यू गॉट कंफ्यूज्ड यू पीपल गॉट कंफ्यूज्ड आई एम नॉट आस्किंग फिब्रिनस पेरिकार्डाइटिस यू गॉट द कंफ्यूज विद द वर्ड एफ फिब्रिनस नहीं पूछ रही हूँ मैं पूछ रही हूँ फिब्रिनोइड नेक्रोसिस Fibrinoid necrosis is one of the type of necrosis. Where the fibrinoid necrosis I have taught you? I have taught you fibrinoid necrosis is one of the necrosis which takes place at the center of the Eschkoff nodule. The center of the Eschkoff nodule is having fibrinoid necrosis. The center of the Eschkoff nodule is having fibrinoid necrosis and Eschkoff nodule is present in myocardium. That's why the correct answer here is myocardium. You got confused with fibrinous pericarditis. That occurs in pericardium, but I am not asking fibrinous pericarditis. Now, don't get confused between the terms. Fibrinoid necrosis is something different. Fibrinous pericarditis is something different. You had a mistake. Yes. So, correct answer here is A, not C. Have you got it? No, Shankdeep, it is not A and C both. The answer is only A. Yes. Myocardium has Eschkoff nodules and Eschkoff nodules have fibrinoid necrosis. That's why I will go with A. Everyone give me a thumbs up. Shankdeep, you got it? So, A is the correct answer. Yes. So, I am done with rheumatic heart disease. One of the five major criteria of Jones criteria. What were Jones criteria, by the way? I was teaching you Jones criteria. What were five major Jones criteria? So, the first one was involvement of heart, rheumatic heart disease. That is already done. The second is involvement of the brain. Sandham's chorea. Involvement of the joints. Involvement of the skin is erythema marginatum. Just below the skin, subcutaneous tissue, subcutaneous nodules. And after that, in the joints, polyarthritis, migratory polyarthritis. So, one of the Jones criteria is done. That is rheumatic heart disease in detail. We have seen pancarditis, all about it. Now, I am teaching you extra cardiac lesion. These four. A small detail about that. So, I am teaching you extra cardiac lesion. That includes four. These four are known as extra cardiac lesions in the rheumatic fever. Shall I start? So, in the extracardiac lesions, we will take one by one all these. These four are extracardiac lesions. Shall I start? I'm starting. The first one is migratory polyarthritis. The first one I'm starting here is migratory polyarthritis. Uske naam mein hi uska matlab hai. Let's split the term. Itis matlab inflammation. Arthra matlab joints. Poly means multiple. Right? So, multiple joints are inflamed. Multiple joints are inflamed. That is the meaning of polyarthritis. And migratory means it is jumping from one joint to another. So there is a child. So the child is in your clinic with the parents, with the mother, with the parents. You are a pediatrician. This is a child. You will ask, what is the complaint? The child will say, I'm having a pain in the shoulder joint. After some time, the same child say, I'm having pain in the elbow joint. After, not in the shoulder, no, in the elbow. And after some time, the same child say, I'm having pain in the wrist joint. Not in the elbow, not in the shoulder. So, it is migratory. After in every few days or few hours, it is migrating from one joint. So, that is migratory polyarthritis. You got my point? Give me a thumbs up. So, that is the meaning of polyarthritis, right? Now, listen. It is the earliest manifestation which occurs after throat infection. You remember the story. I told you the story in the beginning. The child is having tonsillitis. And after tonsillitis, the five major criteria. So, it is the earliest manifestation which occurs within 2 weeks of the throat infection. It is the earliest. This one is the earliest. And it is the most common manifestation. I taught you heart sabse pehle, lekin most common is polyarthritis. So, if some child is having tonsillitis and from the tonsillitis he is developing rheumatic fever. So in 75% cases of rheumatic fever, this is the manifestation, right? Large joints are involved, not small joints, mind it. Large joints may knee joint, ankle joint, wrist joint, elbow joint, shoulder joint, hip joint, but not the fingers. These are the small joints, right? So small joints are not involved, large joints are involved. So if you see the joint, if the child is saying I'm having pain in the elbow, pain in the wrist, pain in the shoulder, examine the joint. That joint is hot. If you touch it, it is acutely hot, like the acute inflammation. It is red looking. It is swollen, right? And it is extremely tender. Child will not allow you to touch it. If you touch it, the child will shout. The child will cry. It is painful. Extremely painful. Pain is out of proportion. Jitna hot or red nahi hai, usse zyada pain hai. So it is looking less hot, less red, but pain is out of proportion. the disproportionate pain is there. That is the finding. Child will shout and it is migratory. It is migratory. Several joints will be involved in quick succession. So one after the another joint is involved. So today child is saying, I'm having pain in the shoulder, the head, red hot joint. And the next day shoulder is okay, but elbow is red hot. Right. The next day wrist is red hot. So the several joints are involved in succession. Right. सबसे पहले एंकल इन्वॉल्व होता है मोस्ट ऑफ द केसेस में, फॉलोड बाय नी, फॉलोड बाय एल्बो, दैट इज पॉलीआर्थराइटिस एंड इट इज अ क्विक सक्सेशन वन आफ्टर द अदर. यू गॉट माय पॉइंट? सो दैट इज माइग्रेटरी पॉलीआर्थराइटिस. बट डोंट गेट कंफ्यूज्ड विद द टर्म रूमेटॉइड आर्थराइटिस. देखो आरआर देके कंफ्यूज मत हो जाना. रूमेटॉइड आर्थराइटिस इज सम अदर डिजीज, पूरी अलग है वो. रूमेटॉइड आर्थराइटिस इज अ डिजीज ऑफ ओल्ड फीमेल आर्थराइटिस, इट इज नॉट अ डिजीज ऑफ चाइल्ड. आई एम टीचिंग यू migratory polyarthritis and rheumatic fever, one of the component of rheumatic fever. Rheumatic fever have five components. One of the component is migratory polyarthritis. I'm teaching you that that occurs in child. And rheumatoid arthritis is a disease which occurs in old age and female. Right? Rheumatoid arthritis may, it is erosive in nature. The joints get eroded. But here in child, it is non-erosive in nature. It's a good thing. It is non-erosive in nature. Give me a thumbs up. What is the treatment? Give simple tablet, Disprin, aspirin. Single tablet, Disprin, aspirin, salicylate, that is salicylate. Even a small dose of salicylate give disproportionately quick response. So the pain will be gone. So give treatment as salicylate, right? That is the characteristic feature, a dramatic response, even a small dose to salicylate. And it is non-deforming, again I'm telling you. In contrast to rheumatoid arthritis in old females, which is deforming. Give me a thumbs up, it is the earliest manifestation I already taught you. Now there is an inverse relationship between arthritis and heart. The first feature, there are five zones right here, no? Till now, this is the second I am teaching you. The first I taught you is rheumatic heart disease. The second I am teaching you migratory polyarthritis. Both are inversely proportional. If the child is having this, the child will not have this. If the child is having this, the child will not have this. I taught you now, out of the five, even if two are present, it is a confirmed case of rheumatic fever. If one is present, one major, you have to look for the minor, right? So these two are inversely proportional. The heart disease and the arthritis. Coming on the next chorea. You got my point? We are done with polyarthritis. Tell me the summary of polyarthritis. Migratory polyarthritis. Who will tell me the summary? It is the earliest manifestation after sore throat, earliest, right? Large joints are involved, small are not involved. The joint is hot, red, tender, and severe pain. The pain is out of proportion. The treatment is aspirin and it is non-deforming. It is non-deforming. I guess all the important points are covered here. And there is an inverse relationship between the migratory polyarthritis and rheumatic heart disease. So that is a summary of this. Coming on the next feature, the brain. Syndamse chorea. The chorea. Syndamse chorea. Right? The next extracardiac lesion is involvement of brain. In rheumatic fever, brain is also involved. And involvement of brain is known as chorea. Why it is known as chorea? I will tell you. The another name of Syndamse chorea is St. Vitus dance. What do you mean by St. Vitus dance? St. Vitus is the name of the first patient in which it is discovered. She was a girl. She was a girl and the name of the girl is St. Vitus. St. Vitus is the name of the girl, right? In which it is discovered. Right? Now, why it is known as dance? Why it is known as, it is looking the baby is dancing, but actually baby is not dancing. Can you see? It is looking like baby is dancing here and there. Actually, it is the involuntary movements of the hands or the limbs in the air. It is involuntary. She cannot control the movements. It is involuntary movements. Involuntary movements of hands or limbs, you can say, limbs in the air. It is looking the baby is dancing, but the baby is not dancing, right? An involuntary movement of the limbs is known as chorea. That's why it is known as chorea. Syndamse chorea. Give me a thumbs up. So why it is known as chorea? Why it is known as St. Vitus dance? Have you got it? Right? It is not that way common. It occurs only 10 to 15% patients of the rheumatic fever. I told you that polyarthritis occurs in 75% of the patient of rheumatic fever. It occurs only 10 to 15%, right? Why it occurs in the brain, which portion of the brain is damaged? Actually, in brain, caudate nucleus. Caudate nucleus got damaged. Why it got damaged? Antigen-antibody reaction. Pura kabada kisne machaya hai? Antibody ne, not the bacteria. So, caudate nucleus have the same antigen as that of bacteria, molecular mimicry. That's why antibodies are cross-reacting and causing this. Give me a thumbs up. So, this is damage to the caudate nucleus. Caudate nucleus, yaad rakhna. Sometimes it is the only feature which is found in rheumatic fever. Out of the five major, only this one can be the major. Sometimes it occurs in isolation, right? But there is a big latent period between the sore throat and this to happen. So it is not the earliest. It occurs after some time. Usually it occurs in girls, pre-pubertal girls, 8 to 12 years ki girls mein hoga hai. and latency period is 1 to 6 months after tonsillitis. So after tonsillitis, after 1 to 6 months, this can happen. And this can happen in isolation also. And this usually occurs in girls, right? And it occurs due to the damage to the caudate nucleus. Remember all important points. Now, what are the symptoms? Two type of symptoms occurs in this patient, neurological and psychiatric. Two type of symptoms, neurological symptoms, psychiatric symptoms. Modern neurological symptoms. Neurological symptoms is chorea. It is chorea, jerky, involuntary movements in the air. That is look like a dance, right? That is chorea. So it is due to the damage to the caudate nucleus and the movements disappear in sleep. During sleep, the child is not doing the dance. During awakened stage, only the child is doing the dance. What are the psychiatric symptoms? The patient have emotional lability. Sometimes the child suddenly cry and suddenly laugh. Suddenly cry, so emotional, very emotional child is there. Hyperactive, the child is very hyperactive. Separation anxiety from the parents. The child do not separate from the parents. Obsession compulsive disorders. So many psychiatric problems are there. So neurological problems, psychiatric problems. Because caudate nucleus governs both. Right, neurological and psychiatric. And damage to the caudate nucleus is there. Now, the movements are characteristic spontaneous. Right, they are purposeless movement and involuntary movement in the ear. Right, this is followed by motor weakness. After some time, the child have motor weakness also. And the movements are exacerbated by stress. If the child is in stress, the movements are more dancing. Right, and they disappear during sleep. During sleep, they disappear. Right, okay. Sex hormones, that is estrogen or pregnancy, can cause the recurrence. Now, when she grow up, now this time we will treat it. We will give the antibiotics, we will give the penicillin, and it will be treated. But when she grow up, she get married, she get pregnant. So the pregnancy or the sex hormone can cause the recurrences at that time also. So it can recur during the pregnancy or the sex. So in your clinic, you are a pediatrician or you are a doctor, how you will do the diagnosis? In OPD basis, how you will do the diagnosis of chorea? How you will confirm chorea? Parents are giving you the history. They are bringing the child to you. Doctor, my child is dancing in the air. Purposeless movements in the air are there. He's not dancing during sleep. But the child is dancing during awakened stage. And when we scold the child, he dance more. Because whenever the parents are scolding the child, don't do that. The child gets stressed. And during stress, the movements are exacerbated. Right? So that is the typical history given by the parents to you. You want to examine the child and confirm the diagnosis. So there are few tests that you will perform in your OPD. The first test is known as milkmaid grip. You know what is milkmaid grip? So just suppose I am the doctor and there is a child in front of me. I want to examine the child and do the examination. So I will give my index finger. I will give my index finger and ask the child to hold my finger. So this is my index finger, you can see. And I will ask the child to hold my finger, right? So if the child is normal, he will hold my finger normally, constantly, like this, right? But if the child is having this, what we are reading, chorea. So the child cannot contract the muscles continuously. So child, what the child will do? Child will squeeze the finger. That is contract, relax, contract, relax, contract, relax. So this is known as squeezing movement. So when I ask the child to hold the finger, can you see? This is the examiner's finger, you can see here. And ask the child to hold it. So child will squeeze the finger, right? Have you seen how the milkman take the milk of the cow out? So why doodh kaise nikalte hain gaay ka? So it is the squeezing movement, right? So it is known as milkmaid grip. The grip is like the milkmaid. The grip is like the milkmaid. So it is contraction relaxation. That is squeezing movement. It is known as squeezing movement. So this test is known as milkmaid grip, right? So irregular contractions of the muscle of the hand while squeezing the examiner's finger. Give me a thumbs up. The second test which you would like to perform is ask the child to extend. You know extension, flexion, extension. Extend the arms. Let me show you the diagram. This is also squeezing movements, right? The irregular contraction, milkmaid grip. Now ask the child to extend the arms. Can you see? This is a child with chorea. I'm asking the child to extend the arms. So when the child is extending the arm, automatically, involuntarily, it will be pronated. You know pronation, supination. The child cannot supinate it. The child is pronating it. So pronation and spoonation. He will contract like a spoon. So pronation and spoonation will happen automatically when you ask the child to extend the arms. So that is the second test. So involuntary will be there. So spoonation and pronation will occur when you ask the child to extend the arms. The third, I don't have diagram for that. Ask the child to take the tongue out. You know, tongue out. So if the child is normal, he will take the tongue out like this. It will be constant like that, right? It will be stable tongue. But if the child is having chorea, if you ask the child to take the tongue out, it will be darting, Vormerian darting movements. It will be like, he will move the tongue constantly here and there. That is known as Vormerian darting movements, right? And the parents will complain the handwriting of the child has also changed since last few days. So that is the fine motor skills are going, right? That is, handwriting is a fine motor skill. So that is the thing. So we are done. We have done the examination. Now chorea coexists with arthritis. It can coexist. Chorea and arthritis can occur. As I told you, arthritis and heart, rheumatic heart disease, never occur in the same patient. Both of them are inversely proportional. Arthritis never occur with rheumatic heart disease, but arthritis can occur with chorea. Give me a thumbs up. What is the treatment? Parents are concerned. Parents are too much concerned. What treatment you will offer to the parents? Nothing. Just consult the parents. Within next few months, the child will be automatically all right. Explain what is the problem in the child. In the child, autoantibodies are formed. Autoantibodies are formed due to the bacteria. Few weeks back, this child have a gas tonsillitis. And autoantibodies are formed that has damaged the nucleus of the brain, because of which the child is having symptoms. Now, in few days, the autoantibodies will automatically eliminate it and child will be all right. So nothing, self-limiting condition within the next few months. But if the next few months also child do not get well, so you can offer valproate, haloperidol, phenobarbital as the treatment, steroids, immunoglobulin. So you can offer all these as a treatment, right? Okay. Coming on the third disease or the fourth one. Till now what we have studied out of the five, what we have studied, the first we have studied is rheumatic heart disease in detail. Yes or no? So all possibility of rheumatic heart disease, that is pancreatitis, I taught you, right? After that, I taught you migratory polyarthritis. All important points we have seen. After that, we have seen chorea. Can you enumerate chorea? All important points. Summarize chorea. Then I will come on the fourth one, erythema marginatum. And fifth one, subcutaneous nodules. Ye do abhi bache hain. Chorea ki summary bolo. Who will tell me the summary of chorea? Tell everything about the chorea. Tell everything. So chorea, the other name is St. Vitus Dans, because of the name of the patient and involuntary movements in the ear, right? So patient have two symptoms, neurological and psychiatric. In neurological, patient have chorea. In psychiatric, patient have obsessive compulsion disorder, emotional liability, separation anxiety. This is all due to caudate nucleus damage in the brain, right? And it is exaggerated by stress. It is exaggerated by female hormones, estrogen. During pregnancy, recurrences are common. And it decreases during sleep. How you will examine? Examination ki, there are four methods of examining OPD basis. So first is milkmaid grip. You already know what is milkmaid grip. After that, ask the child to extend the arms. You will see pronation and supination, pronation and spoonation automatically, involuntarily. You can ask the child to take the tongue out. You can see Vormerian darting movements and see the handwriting. Right, so that is the summary. Treatment is self-limiting. Otherwise, treatment, what are the drugs? I have already told you. I guess, it coexists with arthritis. It can coexist with arthritis. So that is the summary. Coming on the next, the skin involvement. Skin involvement is very rare. In less than 3% patients, it takes place. Only in less than 3% patient, it takes place. What is known as erythema? Erythema means redness. Erythema means redness, redness. So see the lesions. See this diagram. And see this diagram. You will get what are the lesions. Don't describe the lesions. I'm starting describing the lesions. Number one, the lesions are red in color. That's why I will say they are erythromatous. Erythromatous lesions are, red lesions are there, right? I can see at the center of each lesion, there is a yellow macule. Yellow color, center is there. The center, there is a yellow, the lesion is in the form of a macule with yellow center. Yellow center is there, right? The next thing I can see here, the lesions sometimes are serpentine in the form of the snake. Right? The lesions are serpentine. Give me a thumbs up. The next thing I can see, there is no itching in this lesion. No. A big no. No itching in the lesion. Itching means pruritus. So no pruritus. Learn this negative finding. No pruritus. No pruritus or no itching. You got my point? The next, see the location. What's the location on the body? In this diagram, it is present on the trunk. No face involvement. In none of the diagram, I have shown you face. So it is present over the trunk, not on the face, right? Not on the limbs, only on the trunk. So it is known as bathing suit distribution. You know, bathing suit. So bathing suit is a suit which the person wears during swimming or bathing, right? So during swimming or bathing, the suit, where the suit is present, at that portion only the lesions are there. So So soot is not present over the face. So face is spared. That is the meaning. So this is known as bathing soot distribution. Let me see if any point is remaining. So the lesions are erythromatous. They are red in color. They are serpentiginous like snake. They are macular lesions with pale center. I have shown you. Non-pruritic, no itching. I have told you. Lesions are present on the trunk and extremity but not on face. This is known as bathing soot distribution. I guess all points are already covered by me. I have shown you in the diagram. Give me a thumbs up. Here also it is migrating. That's why known as erythema marginatum. Marginatum, the lesions are migrating. And in the end, after a few days, it will subside, no scarring. No scarring like chicken pox. You know, in chicken pox, in the end, there is a scar which is left for the whole life. No, there is no scarring. It will be complete clear skin when it will be treated. Right? So, no scarring in the end. So, coming on the last. So, what is the summary? You got the summary? So, I am done with the next erythema marginatum. Tell me the summary. The lesions are red. They are serpentine. They are no itching. No pruritus. They are migratory in nature. They are absent over face. Present over the trunk and extremities, known as bathing suit distribution, and in this end there is no scarring. No scarring. So this is the summary. I guess you can learn. Give me a thumbs up. Come on, Kishore, Ayush, are you there? Others, are you people there? Shankdeep, shall I move to the last one? The last one is the subcutaneous nodules in the subcutaneous layer. Very, very rare. Only less than 1% patient have this change. So what is happening in this? Can you see here in this diagram? You can see in the subcutaneous layer, there are subcutaneous nodules. So subcutaneous nodules are present in the subcutaneous layer. These are 1 centimeter nodules. They are painless. No pain. Painless nodules. 1 centimeter painless nodules near joints. Near joints. Can you see the elbow joint is there? Near joints. On the extensor surface. Can you see? This is flexor surface. This is extensor surface. So this is the summary. So they are present on the extensor surface, near joints. They are nearly 1 centimeter and painless. Let's see, kuch aur bhi hai kya isme? Let me see. So they are 1 centimeter lesions. They are present along the extensor surface, near bony prominences, and they are associated with carditis. They are painless, non-tender, no pain, no tenderness, and they disappear spontaneously. Most of the lesions disappear spontaneously. So we are done with extra cardiac lesions also. Basically, we are done with rheumatic. But basically, we are done with rheumatic fever. Rheumatic fever. In the rheumatic fever, 5 Jones major criteria, I have explained you all. In detail, we have studied rheumatic heart disease. And in short, we have studied the remaining 4. So, I have taught you syndrome scoria, migratory polyarthritis, erythema marginatum, and subcutaneous nodules. We have seen the details of each of them along with their diagrams. And in rheumatic heart disease, we have seen the pancarditis, the details of all the layers. So, I am done with rheumatic fever. Does anyone have any doubt? Now, we have already done the questions on this part. Now, I am teaching you MCQs of this part. The extra cardiac lesions, right? So, extra cardiac pe kuch polls ho jaye. Are you people ready for the polls? Give me a thumbs up if you are ready for the polls. Give me a minute. Let me again open on the mobile also. There is a screen, but I am afraid if I am missing anything on the screen. Yeah, I can see your chat. Okay. So, this is the first question in front of you. Please tell me the answer. Arthritis and rheumatic fever. About the arthritis and rheumatic fever, all of the following points are true except. Which point is not true? Which is false about the arthritis? Polyarthritis. Tell me, the 4 points are in front of you. Non-deforming, associated with ASO titer, raised ASO titer, last for 3 to 6 weeks in untreated cases, and small joints are involved in usual. So what is wrong in that? I've taught you migratory polyarthritis in detail. So what is wrong in them? Yes, Kishore, you are right. Ayush, you are also right. What about others? Don't want to participate? What about others? I've told you large joints are involved. Small joints never involved. So this point is wrong. This point is wrong. And rest of the points, they are non-deforming. ASO titer will be raised now. That is a guess criteria. So that will fit here because it is a rheumatic fever. So guess criteria will fit. If you don't treat in 3 to 6 weeks, it is automatically treated. So no treatment required. So wrong among them is D. Right? Give me a thumbs up. Give me a thumbs up. Okay. So this is the next question. All are true about subcutaneous nodules except. All are true about subcutaneous nodules except. I'm asking the question about subcutaneous nodules. The last one which I taught you. So it is a delayed manifestation. The painful nodules are there. 3 to 5% patients may it occurs and commonly associated with carditis. You tell me which thing is wrong here. Which thing is wrong here?
I'm asking except. Which thing is wrong here? Can you tell me the answer? So yes, yes. Ayush, Kishore, Mushim, Fatima, you all are right. They are non-painful lesions. I told you painless, non-tender lesions are there. Rest of the things are right. So correct answer here is B because except is asked. The next question. All are true about erythema marginatum except. So the skin manifestation is the erythema marginatum. Can you tell me the answer of the except? Which of the following is not a feature of erythema marginatum? So to read the four options. Barthing suit distribution, early manifestation, pruritic lesion seen rarely, which is not true. So Barthing suit distribution is right. It is the early manifestation. It is a right, but seen rarely. It is also right. But no, these are non-pruritic, non-itching, non-scarring. Non-pruritic, non-itching, non-scarring. I have told you these negative points very, you have to insist on these points. So Kishore, Fatima, Ayush, Mushim, absolutely right. The correct answer here is C. Right. So I am done with the extra cardiac lesions also. Now coming on the clinical features of the rheumatic fever. What are the clinical features of rheumatic fever? So if the child is coming to you, there are 5 major and 4 minor criteria. The child will come to you with any of the clinical feature. Maybe imagine a child is having carditis. So in case of carditis, what will be the clinical features? Child will not come to you and say, doctor, I'm having carditis. Child will give you clinical features. So child will say you, doctor, I'm having dyspnea. I'm having difficulty in breathing because of the valvular lesions, mitral regurgitation, because of the backflow of the blood, the child is having pulmonary edema and that leads to dyspnea. So child will say, doctor or the parents will complain, my child is having breathing difficulty, right? The child is having syncope. You know the meaning of the syncope? Less blood is going to the brain and the child will feeling like, you know, child is having vertigo. So syncope. Pericarditis ki wajah se, you know, fibrinous pericarditis, bread and butter appearance. Child will have pain over the chest, right? So that can lead to the pain. If you auscultate the child, you will hear murmur due to the MR. The MR murmur is Carrie Coombs murmur. You will hear the murmur. You know this is what is this murmur, right? So this is due to the MR, right? Heart block can be there. If you can auscultate, there can be partial heart block. So these are the clinical features, symptoms and signs, right? In case of carditis. If the patient is having Sandham's chorea, what will be the symptoms? The patient is having St. Vitus Dance. Only one symptom. The parents are complaining involuntary movements in the air. That will be the complaint. Apart from it, the patient can have polyarthritis. In case of polyarthritis, patient have arthralgia in the joints. Patient will complain severe pain in the large joints. Right? Apart from it, in case of carditis, ki wajah se edema bhi hoga. In case of carditis, edema will also occur. In case of erythema marginatum, the erythematous lesions can be there. You can see the red color lesions over the skin. In case of subcutaneous nodules, the nodules will be there near the bony prominences. Apart from all these, the GAS criteria. Patient have fever, the minor criteria, the high grade fever and prior sore throat history. So can you understand the complete scenario? So it is not all the symptoms and signs will be present in one patient. The patient can come to you only with carditis, only with chorea, only with arthralgia, only with skin involvement, only. So only one or two or multiple, all 5 can be present in a patient. It's the luck of the patient. Along with prior sore throat in all of them. Everyone give me a thumbs up. These are the clinical features. What investigations you will offer in a patient? You are a doctor. So looking at the scenario, you have a suspicion that this patient is having rheumatic fever. Many of the major and minor criteria are fitting based on symptoms and signs. So you want to confirm your diagnosis. How you will confirm? Mushim, Naval, Ayush, Fatima, Kishore. What you will do to confirm? What investigations you will order to the parents? Just do these investigations in your child. What you will do? So first you will confirm the systemic illness for which you will offer the blood test. 3 blood tests. So do ESR, do CRP and do WBC count. So all these will be raised in the blood. So raised WBC, raised ESR, raised CRP. Yes, you will do that. Evidence of gas infection you want to confirm. Yes. So you will do either throat swab, absolutely right, Kishore. You will do throat swab and you will culture it. So throat culture you will do, or you will look for the antibodies in the blood, anti-ASO titer, anti-streptolysin or anti-DNA titer will be there. Right. Carditis is the most common. No? You want to confirm carditis. How you will confirm? If you are hearing murmurs, you want to confirm carditis. So do a chest x-ray. Cardiomegaly will be there. Pulmonary edema will be there. Do an ECG. In the ECG, you will find either first or second degree AV block. Do an echocardiogram. You will see the cardiac dilatation and valvular abnormalities on the echocardiogram, either MR, MS, AR, AS. So which valve is involved? So these are the investigations you will offer. Okay, the investigations reports are in front of you. Parents have done all the investigation. You are looking at the reports. So based on the clinical features also, and based on the reports also, the diagnosis is confirmed the child is having rheumatic fever. So you have confirmed the child is having rheumatic fever based on the clinical features, symptoms and signs, and based on the investigations. What is the next step? To manage the child. Now parents want their child to be treated. So they will ask about the treatment. What is the treatment of this condition? Okay, these are the symptoms, these are the signs, these are the investigations. You told us that our child is having rheumatic fever. It is a disease due to autoantibodies formed against the bacteria of the sore throat bacteria. Okay, what is the treatment? What is the management? What is the treatment? The treatment, it is a disease which correct automatically. Once the antibodies will be eliminated from the blood, the disease will be automatically treated. But till the disease is treated automatically, it takes few months, maybe 6 months. So till that relieve the symptoms, if symptoms are there, and limit the cardiac damage. Cardiac damage ko limit karna hai hame, right? So ask the patient, ask the child to do bed rest, complete bed rest. Since joint pain can be there, joint pain ki wajah se bhi bed rest mein fayda hoga. So if the child is doing bed rest, so joint pain will be less, right? In case of arthritis, if arthritis is the symptom, right? Arthralgia as the symptom, and it reduces cardiac workload also, because patient already is in MR or MS, so it will reduce the cardiac. So patient is in cardiac failure, right? So do the bed rest. What is the duration of the bed rest? For how many days we will offer the child as a complete bed rest? So till the symptoms are subsided and till the WBC count, ESR become normal, till that point the child should take the bed rest. What is the treatment of cardiac failure? Most important is the cardiac failure treatment. Mnemonic is LMNOP. L is Lasix, offer diuretics, Lasix, right, for the pulmonary edema. M is morphine, offer pain, for pain you offer morphine. N is your NTG, right, that is nitroglycerin. O is the oxygen if required, and P is position of the head is high head position, and rarely pacemaker is required in case of heart block, rarely pacemaker. So that is the treatment of cardiac failure. Give aspirin to the child. Aspirin will help in arthritis. I have already taught you a dramatic response in arthritis with aspirin. If the child is having arthritis, then only give aspirin. So depending what is your major symptom. If the child major symptom is cardiac failure, offer this treatment. If the major symptom is aspirin, offer this treatment. And in both of them, bed rest is a common feature. Joint may be, cardiac may be. Give me a thumbs up. You can give the steroids if severe carditis or severe arthritis is there. Give me a thumbs up, right? So learn the doses by yourself. I'm not going in detail of the doses. Yeah, the most important is the antibiotic. You will give antibiotic. Now listen, what is the antibiotic you will give and why you are giving? The antibiotic, only one antibiotic you will give is penicillin. Only one antibiotic is working here to kill gas bacteria is penicillin. Now, two type of treatment is there. We want to treat this episode. Currently, the child is having major and minor symptoms. And major and minor criteria of the Jones criteria, we want to treat this episode, right? So why the episode is occurring? The beginning is from the bacteria. We want to kill bacteria. The drugs which kill the bacteria are antibiotics. So the best antibiotic here is penicillin. We will give penicillin to the child, right? Penicillin. Kaunsa kya main dose batati hu? I will tell you the doses. And we do not want the recurrence. Recurrences are very common. So we want to give penicillin as a part of treatment also, as a part of prevention also. So doses are different in treatment, in prevention. Treatment ke baad prevention will continue. Pehle treat to karo, first treat this episode. Then give the preventive doses for the next episode. We do not want next. So parents will say, doctor, okay, treat this episode and give some medicine too so that it doesn't occur in future. So we want both treatment. The treatment, curative treatment right now, and the prophylactic treatment for the future, for the next episode. You got my point? For both of them, the drug of choice is penicillin only, right? Now there are two options. We ask the parents, can we give injection to the child? If the parents are comfortable with the injections, and if the child is also comfortable with the injection, give single injection of benzyl penicillin ka single injection. A single dose is sufficient, but that is injectable. The dose is 1.2 million unit per intramuscular injection. You have to give intra. And if the parents and child are not comfortable with the injection, then give oral penicillin. Which penicillin? Phenoxymethyl penicillin. So injectable is benzyl penicillin and oral is phenoxymethyl penicillin. Both are penicillin. This is injectable, single injection, that's it, intramuscular. And if it is oral, you have to give 250 milligram tablets 4 times daily for the next 10 days. So treatment has to be given for 10 days. Injectable, single dose, 1 day. And oral, 4 times a day, 250 milligram for the next 10 days. So whatever comfortable, give that. Now, sometimes the child is allergic for the penicillin. पेनिसिलिन की एलर्जी निकली तो क्या, नाइदर यू कैन गिव दिस नॉट दिस, बोथ आर पेनिसिलिन, सो यू हैव टू ऑफर सम अदर ड्रग, देन इन दैट केस एरिथ्रोमाइसिन और सेफालोस्पोरिन विल वर्क. सो टेल मी द ट्रीटमेंट समरी, देन आई विल गिव यू प्रोफाइलेक्सिस. पहले ट्रीटमेंट तो बताओ, व्हाट इज द ट्रीटमेंट? द ट्रीटमेंट इज पेनिसिलिन. सो इफ इंजेक्टेबल IM और ओरल, सो IM इफ यू आर गिविंग, गो विद बेंजाइल पेनिसिलिन 1.2 million पर यूनिट पर IM इंजेक्शन. And if oral, phenoxymethyl penicillin 250 milligram 4 times a day. That is total 1000 milligram one day for the next 10 days. You got my point? Everyone give me a thumbs up. So this is the doses given in the Harrison for the treatment of this rheumatic fever. That is for the treatment for rheumatic fever. So right, so this portion is from the Harrison, right? So either injectable or oral. Injectable mein another penicillin, oral mein another penicillin. Learn the doses, duration, everything. That is treatment. So child got treated. Okay, the child got treated either by single injection or the 10-day course of oral medicines, oral tablets, whatever. The child got treated. Now treatment is over. Now you want the prophylaxis for the next episode. The parents do not want the next episode to happen, and recurrences are really very common in rheumatic fever. Once the child is prone, so every time the child have tonsillitis, he's prone of developing rheumatic fever. So prophylaxis may be same two drugs are there, right? So every month, the child have to be taken an injection. So either every month take the injection of benzyl penicillin, the same unit, 1.2 million unit, every month. So fix a date in the month. So first of every month, 1st Jan, 1st Feb, 1st March, 1st April, 1st May. So every month fix a date. And on every month, we will take single injection. So that can be the option, right? And if injection is not to be given, then again, oral mein same drug. Oral mein give phenoxymethyl penicillin. You have to give 250 milligram, but not four times, twice daily. Daily, the complete month you have to take. Not for one day of a month, the complete month. So better to go with injection, right? So once the injection, once a month, right? Or completely, daily, the patient is given oral. So the same two penicillins are there. But till how much years, how many years? Just suppose today the child is diagnosed for rheumatic fever. So this episode is treated. This episode is treated, and this time it is treated. So from today I'm starting the prophylaxis. Since how many years ahead I should give the prophylaxis? So it depends. It depends on up to from the age of the diagnosis, from the date of the diagnosis, you can give the prophylaxis for the next 10 years. Either give the prophylaxis for the next 10 years or till the child become 21 years of age, if no valvular lesion, and if with valvular lesion, up to 40 years of age. You got my point? So see the heart involvement. In the heart, if the walls are involved, just like mitral wall, aortic wall, any wall is involved. So till that child become 40 years of age, wo child jab tak 40 saal ka nahi ho jayega, you have to give every month injection for prophylaxis, or for the next 10 years, whichever is longer. You got my point? So that is the duration, right? And if allergy is there, then azithromycin and sulfadiazine can be the another options for the prophylaxis. I am done with rheumatic heart disease. That is rheumatic endocarditis. So let's complete endocarditis. The remaining three endocarditis. What I have told you, endocarditis, there are four types of endocarditis which I am going to teach you today. I have finished rheumatic heart disease or rheumatic endocarditis, the first one. The three are still remaining. That is inflammation of the endocardium. Second is Lippmann's sac endocarditis, which I am teaching today, right now. After that, non-bacterial thrombotic endocarditis. And the last one is the infective endocarditis or bacterial endocarditis. We have finished this one. Everything about this, right? This was the most important. The other three are also important, but not that much detail. Baki sab chote chote hain. Shall I continue? Are you people interested? Shall I continue? It will take another 15 minutes to finish the remaining three endocarditis. But the topic will be over, right? So let me continue with Lippmann's sac endocarditis. I'm coming on non-rheumatic endocarditis. Rheumatic endocarditis is done, right? From medicine also, patho also. Now I'm starting with non-rheumatic one. In the non-rheumatic one, I'm starting with Lippmann's sac. I'm starting with Lippmann's sac endocarditis. Lippmann's sac endocarditis is atypical varicose endocarditis. In Lippmann's sac endocarditis, the patient have SLE. You know what is SLE? It is an autoimmune disease. The patient have SLE, systemic lupus erythematosus, SLE. What is SLE? SLE is an autoimmune disease in which body form antibodies against the DNA, double-stranded DNA. So it is a multi-system involvement, right? So here, the body form autoantibodies against heart also. What is SLE basically? Basically, SLE mein hota kya hai? You may be knowing that all human cell, the body is made up of cell. From head to toe, we are made up of cell, right? And inside the cell, this is the nucleus. Inside the nucleus, this is the double-stranded DNA. So in SLE, the body form autoantibodies against the double-stranded DNA. So double-stranded DNA, anti-double-stranded DNA antibodies are formed. Now DNA is present in all organs. DNA is present in heart also. So the heart cells, the endocardial cells of the heart, body will form antibodies against the DNA of that cells, and due to the antigen-antibody reactions, the vegetations are formed on the heart. Here only endocarditis will occur. Myo and pericarditis will not occur here. Here only endocarditis will be main, right? So in endocarditis, here also vegetations are formed. But the reason for vegetation here is SLE. What is the reason for vegetation? The reason for vegetation is SLE, right? It is not molecular mimicry and cross-reactivity like RHD. Please differentiate. Yahan pe bhi banegi to vegetation. See the vegetations here. See the vegetations. Now, what is the difference between the vegetations here in Lippmann's sac and the vegetations which we have already seen in rheumatic heart disease? What is the difference? See the location. Okay, we will describe the vegetations. In rheumatic heart disease, vegetations were small in size. Here, vegetations are medium size. They are also multiple. In rheumatic disease, they were convex. Here, they are flattened. The meaning of the flattened is verrucous. That's why it is known as atypical verrucous. वहां पे भी vegetation sterile थे, यहाँ पे भी vegetations are sterile. There is no bacteria here also. In rheumatic heart disease, the reason was antigen-antibody reactions, autoantibodies, cross-reactivity. Here, the reason for vegetation formation is SLE, right? So, there is no bacteria here also. So, see, compare the vegetations in rheumatic heart disease with the vegetations in Lippmann's sac. You can see. Can you see the size here is small? Yes. Can you see the size here? The size here is medium size. It is not small. Here also, here small. Here medium size. Right? We can see. Here also multiple. Here also multiple. Here also sterile. No bacteria is there. Here also sterile. No bacteria is there. Give me a thumbs up. Come on. So that is the vegetations we have seen. Now tell me the wall. Which wall? In rheumatic heart disease, the mnemonic was MATP. Here also the most common wall is mitral only. Mitral and tricuspid are most commonly involved. You can learn the same mnemonic. But the location is different. Can you tell me the location on rheumatic heart disease? What was the location in rheumatic heart disease I taught you? Ayush, Kishore, Naval, what was the location? The location on rheumatic heart disease was the junction. That is the closure of the walls, right? So here the location is not junction. Here the location is not junction. Let me draw the heart. Let me draw the four chambers. This is the left side. This is the right side. Let me draw the mitral wall to explain you. The two cusps of the mitral wall. Now, this is left auricle. You all can see. This is left ventricle. You can see the two cusps of the mitral wall, the red color wall. These are the two cusps, right? Just suppose my two hands are two cusps. So, this is auricle. This is ventricle. These are the two cusps. When the two cusps are separating, blood is coming from auricle to ventricle. And when the two cusps are closing, the blood is not coming. So, this is the normal cardiac cycle. We can see they are opening, closing. Now, in the upper surface is auricular surface. The lower surface is ventricular surface. Say yes or no. So, the two surfaces are there and apart from it, junction is there. So, in rheumatic heart disease, we have seen the vegetations are formed at the junction. Neither on upper nor on lower on the junction. But here, in Lippmann's sac endocarditis, that is SLE endocarditis, the vegetations are formed on upper as well as lower surface, not on junction. It is formed on upper also. It is formed on lower also. So, both surfaces have vegetation. Please mind it. Have you got it? Give me a thumbs up if you got it. So, upper surface also have vegetation. Lower surface, so upper auricular and ventricular. Both surfaces have surface ke upar vegetation. Right? So, both surfaces have vegetation. Not only this. This is the wall now. The continuity of the wall is the auricular. Ye auricle aa gaya. Right? Yahan dono side auricle aa gaya. And the continuity of this wall is the ventricle. Right? And the corners are known as pockets. These corners are known as pockets. So, vegetations are formed on the upper surface and lower surface. They extend to the pocket and from the pocket, they continue on the auricular and ventricular surface. Now, see the diagram. The beauty of the diagram I have drawn. See, appreciate it. Have you got it? I have drawn the vegetations on upper surface. Say yes or no. I have drawn the vegetations on the lower surface. Say yes or no. I have continued the vegetations in the corners. That is pockets. And from pockets, I have continued on the auricular surface also. And I have continued on the ventricular surface also. So, this is the location. Now, wait. Both surfaces, upper and lower. Not only both surfaces, along the pockets also, the corners also, and the adjoining ventricular and auricular wall also. Everyone gave me a thumbs up. Now see the beauty of the diagram here, the robins have shown. See, robins ne isko flip karke dikhaya hai. Why the robins have flipped this surface? There is no flip in other. There is flip here.
just to show you the vegetation are on upper surface as well as lower surface. Robin is a great author. उसके डायग्राम में ही सब कुछ है, उसको बोलने की जरूरत नहीं है. एवरीथिंग इज शोन इन द डायग्राम. समझदार चाहिए समझने के लिए डायग्राम. यू गॉट माय पॉइंट? सो वेजिटेशन इज प्रेजेंट ऑन द अपर एज वेल एज लोअर सरफेस. इट इज क्रिस्टल क्लियर इन दिस डायग्राम. नो नीड टू से इट्स फ्लिप फ्लैप. ऐसा उसको उल्टा करके दिखाया है कि देखो वेजिटेशन नीचे भी है. सो वेजिटेशन इज ऑन द अपर एज वेल एज लोअर सरफेस, राइट? सो यू विल नेवर फॉरगेट नाउ, राइट? सो दैट इज द थिंग. इट इज प्रेजेंट ऑन द सरफेस. नाउ वन मोर थिंग हियर, सी द टू कस्प. दिस इज रूमेटिक हार्ट डिजीज. And see the two cusp here, right? This is Lippmann's egg. Here you can see vegetations are at the junction, not over the surface. And here it is present on the surface. This diagram is from some other group, right? Deformity, यहाँ पे कोई deformity नहीं होगी. Their deformity was MR. यहाँ पे कोई खास deformity नहीं होगी. So we are done with Lippmann's egg also. So let me compare rheumatic fever with the Lippmann's egg endocarditis. Let me compare. We compare these two, then I start the third one, right? So who will help me in comparing? Anyone? So here the vegetations are small, here they are medium, right? Here they are convex, not written, you can write. Here they are flat. Flattening is a hallmark here. They are flat. They are flat and varugous. Flattening is known as varugous, right? Here they are along the line of closure, that is junction. Here they are both surface, upper, lower. Not only this, they are present on the pocket also, and they are present on adjoining endometrium, auricle and varicle also. So that is the complete story, right? Here the reason is rheumatic fever. Antigen antibody, auto antibodies are formed. And here the reason is SLE, right? Here they produce fish mouth deformity, buttonhole deformity and MR. Here they do not produce any deformity, right? Here you can see they are sterile. Here also they are sterile. So sterile is a common feature. Shall I come on the third? I'm starting the third one. Non-bacterial thrombotic endocarditis known as NBTE. Non-bacterial means it is not infective. The fourth one is the bacterial, no? The last one will be infective or bacterial. This one is non-bacterial. Non-bacterial. Okay, non-bacterial. Then what is the reason? The reason is thrombosis. Thrombosis will occur. Thrombotic endocarditis. So see the meaning of the name. Naam mein hi uska matlab chupa hai. Non-bacterial. Here bacteria will not come. It is also sterile. Right? Bacteria will not cause the lesion. The lesion, the vegetation is due to thrombosis in the wall of the heart. In the wall of the heart, thrombus will form. And that thrombus, actually the thrombus is a nodule. That will form the vegetation. So that leads to endocarditis. So non-bacterial thrombotic endocarditis, here also vegetations are formed. So since here, the vegetation is formed by the thrombus in the heart, in the wall of the heart. So again, they are sterile, bacteria is absent. And why the thrombus is formed? It is the hypercoagulable state. So sometimes blood becomes hypercoagulable. And without injury, it start forming thrombus. Multiple microthrombi are formed and the microthrombi are present in the walls of the heart, right? So that is the reason. So reason here is hypercoagulability. What is the reason in rheumatic heart disease? The reason in rheumatic heart disease, the reason for vegetations is rheumatic fever. That is molecular mimicry and cross-reactivity of antigen-antibody reaction. What is the reason in Lippmann's egg? The reason in Lippmann's egg is SLE. What is the reason in NBTE, non-bacterial thrombotic endocarditis? The reason here is hypercoagulability of the blood, which leads to thrombus formation. Crystal clear concepts. Shall I proceed ahead? See the vegetations here. Can you see the vegetations here? Can you see the vegetations here? Here vegetations are again at the junction. Again at the junction, like rheumatic heart disease, the first one. So again only at the junction, you can understand the meaning. So here vegetations are again small or medium size. They are more friable, they are sterile, and they are single or multiple. And they are present at the junctions. They are again present along the line of the closure and junction. The walls are same, mattam. Ye hamesha same rahega. The mnemonic is same, mattam. So most commonly all the vegetations are on mitral wall. Compare rheumatic heart disease, the first one I taught you. The second I taught you is Lippmann's egg. And third currently I am teaching you is NBT. So first comment on their size. Here I can see all of them are small. Here I can see they are medium. Here also I will say medium. Here they are multiple. Here also multiple, here also multiple. Everywhere it is sterile. So I will write sterile. But the reason is different. Here the reason is rheumatic fever, antigen antibody reaction, autoantibodies are formed. Here the reason is SLE. And here the reason is hypercoagulability of the blood leading to the thrombus formation. Give me a thumbs up. Now tell me the location. The most important point to be taken care of is the location. Who will tell me the location? Here the location is line of closure. That is the junction. In rheumatic heart disease, right? In SLE, the location was both surfaces, upper as well as lower.
apart from it pockets, you can see both surface. Apart from it upper and lower, see the flip-flap. Apart from it pockets and adjoining endometrium also, right? And here also it is present on the junction. That is line of closure. So can I say the location is same in RHD and NBTE? In rheumatic heart disease and non-bacterial thrombotic endocarditis, the location is same. Location is important. See the size. See their number. Size is different. Small, medium, medium. Number is same. All of them are multiple, right? See whether they are sterile and bland. All of them are sterile till now. The fourth one, ye wala non-sterile hoga, it contains bacteria. This is non-sterile. It will be infected, right? The fourth one, which I am going to teach you next, right? See the location, right? That's important. See the reason why they are formed. So in this way, you have to compare the vegetations. Give me a thumbs up. Ayush, Kishore, are you people there? Give me a thumbs up. Give me a thumbs up. So see the diagram. Can you see NBTE vegetations? See, they are present on the junction. They are present on the junction. Only on the junction. And see, they are medium size. They are on the junction. Right? So, and deformity here also, nodules are formed. No severe deformity. So that's about it. So we are done with the third also. Till now, we are done with three. Can we compare the three to start the fourth one? The last one I will teach you then. Rheumatic fever, Libman's sac, and NBTE. Till now, we are done with three. Can you help me? Yes. These are small. These are medium. Make it medium also. This is small. These both are medium. Tell me the reason. This is seen in rheumatic fever. This is seen in SLE. This is seen in hypercoagulable state. Right? Tell me the reason. Right? Tell me these three. All three are sterile. All three are sterile. The next, tell me their location. Location. This is along the line of closure, along the line of closure, and this one is on the bone surface. This is the most simplified way I can teach you. Which are flat? These one are flat. SLE wale alag se flat yaad rakhna. Don't forget. Have you got it? Naval, Kishore. Coming on the last one. The last one are infective endocarditis. So before that, would you like to do some questions based on these two? These two, NBTE and Libman's sac? We will so do few questions. So this is the first question in front of you from the previous year question papers. Can you tell me the answer, anyone of you? Flat vegetations are seen. Flat vegetations are seen in the pockets of the wall. Two clues, and there are two clues in the question. Pick the clues. Number one clue, the vegetations are flat. Number two, they are present in the pocket. So dono clue combine karte huye, what is your answer? Kishore, absolutely right. So only Kishore want to participate. What about others? What about others? Yes, Naval, absolutely right. Yes, Vaidehi, very good. So it is Libman's sac. Fatima, very good. Libman's sac. So two clues were in the question. You know the answer. Correct answer is B. So it is Libman's sac. The vegetations are flat and they are in the pockets. Right? So correct answer is B. Yes, Ayush. Very good. This is the next question in front of you. Which type of endocarditis have vegetations? Okay. On both sides of the wall. On both sides of the wall. Upper surface as well as lower surface. Upper and lower. Upper and lower. Both sides of the wall. What is your answer now? What is your answer now? So yes, again the answer is Libman's sac. Again that. So let me come on the question. Listen, everyone. Everyone here. In rheumatic fever, they are present along the line of the closure, that is junction. Neither upper nor lower, that is junction. In NBTE also, again they are present at the line of closure. Neither upper nor lower, that is at the junction. In SLE, they are present on both surface, upper as well as lower, which is our question now. Infective maine abhi padhaya nahi hai, par bata deti hu abhi. So in infective endocarditis, the fourth one, it is present only on upper. Only on upper. So say the summary, on the junction, on both surface, on upper surface. In this sequence, I'm telling you. So what is the summary? In rheumatic fever, the vegetations are present only at junction. In NBTE, they are present at the junction. Neither upper nor lower, at the junction. In Libman's sac, SLE, they are present on both surface, upper as well as lower. Right? In infective endocarditis, only on upper. So both surface, which is our question. Our question kya hai? Our question is on both surface that occurs only in Libman's sac. Now read the question, right? So which type of endocarditis have vegetations on both surface? So answer is Libman's sac. You all are right. I'm changing the question. Here instead of both surface, I'm saying only on upper surface. What is your answer now? Vaidehi, what is the answer? Ayush, Fatima, what is the answer now? Kishore. So only on upper surface, answer will become A automatically, right? So that is the beauty of the question. And instead of that, if I ask neither upper nor lower, I'm asking the junction, line of closure, answer will become C in that case, right? So depending on the location, answer may vary. Currently, the answer is B, right? So shall we move to the next question? This is the next question in front of you. Vegetations in Libman's sac. Libman's sac. Can you describe the vegetation? Read the four options. Which option is best suiting? I'm giving you time. Describe the vegetations in Libman's sac.
सो एक एक करके ऑप्शंस देखते हैं. आर दे लार्ज एंड फ्रेजाइल? दे आर नॉट लार्ज, दे आर मीडियम. लेट मी सी अदर ऑप्शन. अगर कुछ नहीं अच्छा मिला तो आई विल गो विद दिस, राइट. लेकिन इससे कुछ बेटर मिल गया तो लार्ज तो नहीं होते हैं, दे आर मीडियम साइज, राइट. दे आर फ्रेजाइल, आई एग्री, बट दे आर नॉट लार्ज, दे आर टू बी प्रिसाइज, दे आर मीडियम, राइट. लेट मी सी अदर ऑप्शंस. दे आर स्मॉल, ओके, नॉट स्मॉल, बट आई कैन कंसिडर स्मॉल. वार्टी अलॉन्ग द लाइन ऑफ द क्लोजर? Along the line of the closure? No, they are not on line of closure. They are present on both surfaces. So this option is wrong. This is wrong. Coming on the third option. They are small or medium. Okay, I can consider they are small or medium and on either surface, both surface. Yeah. So this is the best option. They are small. They are not small. They are bland but not small. Right. So some options are partially correct, partially incorrect. But the best to go with is C. Right, the best is to go with C. You all are right. Naval, Kishore, Ayush, Fatima, Vedai, very good. The correct answer here is C. Right, so coming to the next question. The next question, vegetations below the wall. Below the wall. In which of the following below? Vegetations are present on below. Below se mera matlab hai lower surface. Lower surface. Not is a tricky question. The question is simple, but yeah, yet tricky. So the four type of endocarditis are in front of you. Right. Is it rheumatic? Is it Lippmann-Segg? Is it NBT? What you will say? So lower पे तो किसी पे भी नहीं होते हैं, लेकिन आप both पे होते हैं, right? So in Lippmann-Segg it occurs in both. It occurs in, yes Kishore, it occurs in both. So both includes lower also ना? Yes Kishore, so both includes lower also. So that's why my answer is A. सिर्फ below पे तो किसी पे भी नहीं होते हैं, out of the four. So you know what is the summary? In rheumatic fever, at the junction. In NBTE, at the junction. In Lippmann-Segg, it is at both. Both includes upper and lower. In infective, only upper. Now read the question. I'm asking the question lower, below surface. Below surface to kisi mein bhi nahi hai. But yeah, both includes lower. That's my answer. You got my point? Mushim, Naval, Fatima. Yes, the correct answer here is A. That is the reason. Right? So coming on the last one. You want me to continue? The last one? It will take another 10 minutes. I will finish. The topic will be finished. Warna wo rahi jayega. Right? So infective or bacterial endocarditis. One and the same thing. Either you say infective or you say bacterial. It is one and the same thing, right? So infective or bacterial endocarditis, it is little bit larger, right? So I will give you a little bit detail here, right? So infective or bacterial endocarditis, what's the reason for vegetation formation here? The reason for vegetation formation is the bacteria. Bacteria. The bacteria will come and it will form the vegetation. The bacteria will destroy the wall. And due to the destruction of the wall caused by the bacteria, a nodule will be formed there. And that nodule is known as vegetation. So vegetations are infected, they are not sterile, they are not bland, they contain bacteria. In contrast to other three endocarditis where the vegetations were sterile. Here vegetations are due to bacteria only, so how they can be sterile? They cannot be sterile. Now it is of two types, Abe and Sabe. What is the full form? Acute bacterial endocarditis and subacute bacterial endocarditis. The two types, Abe, Sabe. Acute, subacute, bacterial endocarditis. Now listen a story. I'm telling you a story. Everyone listen. Can you see the two hearts in front of you? Of course, you all can see the two hearts in front of you. Let me tell you a story of the two hearts. The first patient is a healthy patient. He is having healthy walls. This mitral wall is absolutely healthy. The second patient is already having a disease in the mitral wall. So that's why prosthetic wall output. Here, the healthy walls are not there. The heart walls are weak and they are prosthetic. They are prosthetic, right? So since here the healthy wall is there, a bacteria is coming. So the bacteria which want to cause that damage to the healthy wall, that bacteria should be highly virulent. Say yes or no. And here the walls are already damaged. They are already prosthetic. They are artificial walls. So here even a less virulent bacteria, less powerful bacteria can cause the damage. Agree or do not agree? Here the walls are healthy. They are strong. Healthy walls are there. So strong bacteria is required. Highly virulent bacteria is required to damage. Right? The example of highly virulent bacteria is Staph aureus. Staph aureus. Staphylococcus aureus. Staphylococcus aureus will cause the damage here. And here, when the walls are already prosthetic, damaged, weak, so even a less virulent bacteria can cause the damage. So example of such bacteria is Streptococcus viridians. It is not Staphylococcus. It is Streptococcus viridians. So learn the name of the bacteria, right? Now here, since I have told you, the bacteria is highly virulent. So in less than 6 weeks, it will cause the damage, right? And here, since the bacteria is very weak, bacteria is less powerful. So it will require more than 6 weeks to cause the damage. So this is practically Abe. This is practically Sabe. Give me a thumbs up. Abe is acute. It is very fast. Less than 6 weeks, the walls are damaged. And Sabe is practically very slow. So it requires more than 6 weeks. So same story is written in front of you. Here the walls are healthy. Here walls are diseased.
Here more powerful bacteria is required. Here less virulent bacteria bhi chalega. So here Staph aureus less than 6 weeks. Here Streptococcus viridians more than 6 weeks. This is Abe, this is Sabe. Now you will never forget. Give me a thumbs up. So tell me what is Abe. What is acute bacterial endocarditis? Here a highly virulent bacteria is required. Like Staph aureus. Because the heart walls are normal. That's why highly virulent are required. And since the bacteria is powerful, highly virulent, in less than 6 weeks, it will damage the wall. It will produce the vegetations in less than 6 weeks. Right? What is Sabe? What is Sabe? Subacute. As the name indicates, it is subacute. It is not acute. Subacute. It is known as endocarditis lenta. Lenta was a slow. Lenta is a Greek word that means slow. So here, the walls are previously damaged. Give me a thumbs up. Kishore, Fatima, you got it? Mushim, Nawal, you got it? So the walls are previously damaged. Right? So even a less virulent bacteria will work. Right, that can cause the damage because the walls fallacy damaged. So, zyada virulent bacteria ki zarurat nahi hai. The example here is Streptococcus viridians, right? And since the bacteria is less powerful, less virulent, so it requires more time. It requires more than 6 weeks to do the damage. So, one is Abe, one is Sabe. So, see the differences between Abe, Sabe, we have already seen. Here, less than 6 weeks, more than 6 weeks. Highly virulent bacteria, less virulent bacteria. High virulent bacteria, the example is Staph aureus. Less virulent bacteria, the example is Streptococcus. Viridians. This is Staphylococcus, this is Streptococcus, right? Here, previously the heart walls are normal. Previously the heart walls are damaged. So one is Abe, one is Sabe. We have seen that. Now coming on the etiology, we have already done the etiology. I'm skipping it, right? So in Abe, it is Staph aureus. In Sabe, it is Streptococcus viridians. We have already done that. Let me skip it. There are many predisposing factors. If the heart walls are previously damaged, so because of all these conditions, the heart walls can be previously damaged, right? Okay. Pathogenesis, yeah. So, Gross already know, in Sabe, the heart walls are previously damaged. In Abe, they are normal. We already know these points. Yeah, coming on the directly vegetations. Here, the vegetations are large. So, compare the four vegetations in size. In the first rheumatic heart disease, they were small. In Lipman sac, as well as NBT, both of them, they were medium size. And I'm saying now they are large. So, small, medium, medium, large. If you are talking in a sequence. Right? Here, the vegetations are large. इतने बड़े कि दे आर फ्राइबल वो टूट ही जाएंगे वहां से. कैन यू सी द डायग्राम? हियर आई विल ड्रॉ द वेजिटेशंस. कैन यू सी द वेजिटेशंस? दे आर बिग बिग वेजिटेशंस, बिग वन. इतने बड़े कि दे विल जस्ट स्प्लिट फ्रॉम देयर, दे विल जस्ट डिग्रेड फ्रॉम देयर. सो दे आर हाईली फ्राइबल. सिंस दे आर लार्ज, दे विल टूट जाएंगे. जितना बड़ा है टूटने के चांसेस उतना ज्यादा है. सो द साइज इज डायरेक्टली प्रोपोर्शनल टू द फ्राइबिलिटी, आई वांट टू से. राइट? सो दे आर लार्ज, दे आर फ्राइबल. दे कैन बी सिंगल, दे कैन बी मल्टीपल एंड इररेगुलर. दे आर वेरी बल्की. दे आर वेरी बल्की. ग्रॉसली इफ यू टॉक अबाउट. So tell me the location. Can you see the four walls I have shown in the diagram? In all four walls I have seen, I have drawn them on the upper surface. Only on the upper surface. So it can occur, the sequence is same. The sequence is same. Most common mitral, least common pulmonary. But in all of them, they occur only on upper surface. Everyone give me a thumbs up. Everyone. One more point I would like to highlight here. Whether you get it or not, I don't know. These walls are known as auriculoventricular wall. Atrioventricular wall. Because they separate atria from the ventricle. So, mitral wall and tricuspid wall are known as atrioventricular wall. I guess you know that. And these two walls, pulmonary and aortic wall, these are known as semilunar walls. Semilunar walls. You know that? I guess you know that. Right. Now, let's talk about atrioventricular wall. On which surface the vegetations are there? Vegetations are only on upper surface. Right. Vegetations on all of them are on upper surface. But let me tell you, what is the upper surface in AV wall? What is the upper surface in lamp semilunar walls? Dekho wall, dekho. See the walls. See the walls. Okay, see the wall here. See AV walls. The upper surface of AV wall. Can you see it is atrial surface? Atrium. Atrium is going upper surface. And lower surface is the ventricular. So can I say in AV walls it occurs on atrial surface? Atrial means upper surface. Yes or no? And can I say in semilunar walls? What is the upper surface of semilunar wall? In semilunar wall, the upper surface is ventricular surface. The lower is either aorta or pulmonary wall. This is aorta. This is pulmonary vein. Give me a thumbs up. Give me a thumbs up. So, in AV wall, it occurs on atrial surface. In semilunar wall, it occurs on ventricular surface. Agar ye samajh mein aaya, to achhi baat hai. Nahi samajh mein aaya, note mat lo. Just learn upper surface. It always occurs on the upper surface of all walls. Right? Learn the summary. So, what is the location? What is the location? So, see. Where I have written this. What I have told you, I have written it somewhere, no? Aayega, kahin na kahin aayega. Theek hai. So, can you see the four diagrams now? See all four diagrams. They are in front of you. See infective endocarditis. This one. See the vegetations. They are bulkier. They are large. Here I have shown only single. All of them are multiple, multiple, multiple.
Usually it is bulky and single, but can be multiple. See the size. Compare the size. Here they are small. Here they are medium. Here they are medium. Here they are large. Since they are large, they are friable. See the location. Can you tell me the location? Here it is the junction. Here on both surfaces along with pockets. And here only on upper surface. So you got it. The mnemonic is same, Mattak. That you don't have to bother. The mnemonic is same everywhere, Mattak. Right? So most common wall involved is mitral wall. Always mitral wall. Location, read the location that I was telling you. So it is the atrial surface of AV wall and ventricular surface of semilunar wall. This line is given in Robbins. So, mujhe ye samajhne mein bahut time lag gaya tha. But you got it. So, I mean upper surface of all wall. Have you got it, everyone? So, atrial surface of AV wall and ventricular surface of the semilunar wall. So, it is the upper surface of all walls. Right? So, that is. And here also, it can go to the pockets and adjacent endometrium like Lipman's sac. Right? Here also, it can do. So, we are done with that. You can see they are very destructive. You can see the vegetations, right? They are present on the upper surface. They can ulcerate, they can perforate, they can cause the abscess. Yahan pe pus bhar jayega. Inside the vegetation, pus can be there because bacteria is there. So you can see pus-filled vegetations. They are purulent. They are pus-filled. They form the abscess. They ulcerate, they perforate. So most destructive. Among the four, they are the most destructive. Most destructive because bacteria is present in them. Most destructive as compared to others. So they ulcerate, they perforate, they form abscess, right? And the most destructive one are the vegetations of infective endocarditis. They are the largest, they are the most tribal, they are the most destructive. Give me a thumbs up. Everyone, give me a thumbs up. Everyone. So, can we compare the four and end this lecture now? So, thoda sa portion bacha hai. One more portion which is remaining that you have to read by yourself. Okay, the complications of this one. Infective. So, cardiac complication. In the cardiac, they will form abscess. They will form abscess inside the wall. The abscess form in the wall. That is the most common complication in the heart. And extra cardiac. You can see pus-filled abscess. Please appreciate the pus-filled abscess. These all images are from Robbins and they come for image-based questions, right? And in extra cardiac complication, why extra cardiac should happen, right? Listen, any vegetation on the left side of the heart, I've said the vegetations are large and they are friable, so they will split. Once the vegetation is split, it is friable. It is known as embolus. It is no more vegetation now. Once it will get split, it is embolus. So all left side vegetation which will get split, they will go in aorta. They will go in aorta and obstruct the various organs in the aorta. Right? All the vegetations on the right side of the heart, they will split and they will go in the pulmonary vein and they will go in the lungs. Am I right? I guess I am right. So all the vegetations on the right side of the heart, they will obstruct lung. And all the vegetations on the left side of the heart, they will form emboli and obstruct aorta and go to the various organs. So extra cut. So the same diagram is drawn here, right? From the left side, they are going in aorta. From the right side, they are going in the lungs. From the left side, from aorta, they can move technically to any organ. So see the extra cardiac complications. So they are going to the hands. From the aorta, they are going to the nails and the hands, the fingers, right? And they can produce lesions here. So two type of lesions are formed. One is Janaway's port, one is Osler node. These two are extra cardiac complications of infective endocarditis. Janaway are seen in Abai and Osler are seen in Sabe. Let me write here. This is Osler seen in Sabe and this is Janaway. They are seen in Abai. First learn that. Janaway in Abai, Osler in Sabe. You know what is Abai and Sabe. Now what is the difference between them? Let me tell you the difference. You can see Osler is present at the tip of the finger. They are painful, number one. Painful. Pain is present. And they are present at the tip of the finger. Right? Here, Janaway, they are present on the palm, not at the tip of the finger. They are present on palm and they are not painful. Pain is absent here. You got my point? Say yes or no? So typically, crystal clear in the diagram. You can see Osler, you can see Janaway. This is the tip of the finger, this is the palm. So here pain is absent, here pain is present. I'm a little bit fast because mujhe khatam karna hai session. Right? So Osler are seen in Sabe. And Janaway are seen in Abai. Both are due to extracardiac lesions seen in the heart. Now, the last thing you read by yourself is the Duke criteria. I taught you rheumatic heart disease, the first endocarditis, right? In that, I told you Jones criteria, the major, the minor, 5 major, 4 minor, and gas criteria. Now, I'm teaching you infective endocarditis. In infective endocarditis, there are Duke's criteria, the major and minor, right? So, instead of Jones, yahan pe Duke's criteria hai, but you read by yourself. There are three major. I'm not reading them. Read the three major. Read the five minor. So these are the Duke's criteria, right? So I am done. I guess I am done. With the four type of endocarditis, I am done. But there are questions based on infective endocarditis, but I'm unfortunately ending this session. So you can ask for the notes. I will send you my PDF, which currently I'm teaching you. You can read from my notes, or my notes are from Robbins only. Robbins, Harshmohan, and few other textbooks combining all of them. So you can ask the notes on the Telegram. I will share it with you. And I'm ending the session right now. Thank you very much for being with me. If you like the lecture, don't forget to click on the like button before leaving the session. Please share the links on your batch groups with your colleagues, with your seniors, juniors, interns, everywhere, with technically all the medicals throughout the globe. Please share. So it is a free education. Everyone should get benefit of it, and they should aware that something good is available on the YouTube, right? And my next session will be tomorrow morning. So tomorrow morning, again, I will start at 7 a.m. in the morning and continue with the blood vessels. So I will continue with the blood vessels, atherosclerosis, aneurysm, this lesson, and I will start some other system tomorrow morning. So I will continue definitely with the pathology only, with the systemic pathology. So I am available on the Telegram. I'm available on the Telegram. Search me by MedLife by Dr. Priyanka. MedLife by Dr. Priyanka. This is my Telegram ID, Priyanka. And you can search me by my name also, Dr. Priyanka Sachdev. So that is my name. So search me by my name, Dr. Priyanka Sachdev, S-A-C-H-D-E-V. So search me by my name, or my channel is MedLife by Dr. Priyanka. You can join me on the channel on Let's Crack Neet PG Telegram group of an academy. So you can search me the members of the group and text me your doubts, right? So here I would like to stop. Thank you very much for being with me. Thank you for giving your precious time to me. There are few announcements by the team for you people. I'm sorry. Let me do those announcements. Okay. Just a second. I'm not having it currently with me. Okay, I got it. I'm sorry. So you can see that on an academy, new batches are already started for 2023 NEET PG, right? So you can enroll for the batch once you take the subscription. The repeaters batch is already there, and you can enroll in that batch also. Iconic prices are rising soon, in within few days. So if you are thinking of taking the subscription, take it now. Otherwise, the price rise is already there. It is on the plan. So on an academy, we have five type of subscriptions for you. So plus subscription, you will get only an academy. In iconic, along with an academy, you will get prep letter also. In light subscription, you will get the test series. In prop 1, you will get anatomy, biochemistry, physiology classes. In UPSC subscription, you will get UPSC preparation. So whatever suits you, you can go for that subscription. If you wish, if you need, you can take that particular subscription for that particular plan, particular duration. The prices are in front of you. You select your best plan for you. Longer the plan, cheaper it is. But if you are not sure, you can select as small as 3 months, as large as 4 years. So all ranges are available. Select any plan, and you can apply my code before payment. My code is Sachdev10. My surname is Sachdev, Dr. Priyanka Sachdev. So it's S-A-C-H-D-E-V, Sachdev without space 10. This is my code. If you apply this before payment on any of the plan, you will get straightforward 10% discount on the plans. I request you to share my links to all your friends, colleagues, seniors, juniors, batchmates, everywhere. And connect me tomorrow morning on the YouTube. And if you're a second prof student, tomorrow evening, in the morning, I will continue on the YouTube for the competitive exam only. In the evening, I'm going to take a special session, that is practicals, pathology practicals, in which I'm going to take all spotters, all museum specimens, all histopathology slide discussion, all the practical exercises, the pipe exercises, that is hemoglobin estimation, urine examination, blood grouping, you know, DLC, everything. The most important question for Viva Bose. I'm going to discuss everything about practicals in pathology. So if you are a second prof student, or if you are any friend, colleague, senior, junior is in second prof, so please inform that from tomorrow, the free series is starting on an academy app. So please catch me on the Telegram for the details. Bye-bye, study hard. And I'm Andy.